Happy Whiskey Wednesday, everyone, and welcome back to the Bourbon and BS podcast. This is episode 109. We've had an interesting couple of weeks, and it's been an interesting day for us here in Columbus, Ohio, that are involved with the Smoking 10 event, and we will get into that just momentarily. But I do have some bad news about that, so we'll get to that. We'll get to that. But I want to thank our guests and welcome our guests. We have Nate Blury.
Yeah.
He is with St. Liberty Whiskey and other companies, I believe.
Absolutely.
we'll dive into a couple of these things as we get started. And then we have Nook Mercer from CLE, Eiroa, Asylum, which just any of them?
Yeah.
Just any of them. So,
all of them.
thank you guys for being here tonight. It's going to be a very busy week. The week is still going to be busy, but it has gotten a little freed up, unfortunately, recently. So, Nate, if you want to go ahead and do the sponsors while I share this, and I encourage everyone out there to share this to your page, any businesses that you think would be relevant, if you guys are in charge of business pages, groups, anything that is relevant, or share it with your friends, family, everything else, so they can contribute to the conversation.
So for tonight's episode, we want to thank Nook and CLE for providing the cigars for this evening. The first one we're going to be smoking is the Eiroa First 20 Year, and then the second one is going to be the CLE Azabache. And from now until the close of shop next Tuesday, the Azabache will be 15% off at the Tinder Box if you mention the podcast, which brings up our other sponsors. Tinder Box at Easton Town Center, Columbus, Ohio. Then you also have, typically our second cigar is going to be coming from Altadis USA, but because we have Nook here, both cigars are coming from CLE, thanks to Nook. But we still want to give a shout out to Josh and Paul and everyone at Altadis USA for making the sponsorship for year two happen. And then also the BS Cigar Company, we got the brand new BS Gold back in, and we are all really excited about it. Heard many great things about it during the course of the last week. So we are excited to have those floating around as well. Once again, it seems like it's been forever since we've been able to have those floating around the shop, the BS Golds at least. Don't forget about the Patreon page, patreon.com/bourbonandbspodcast. Getting closer to finalizing the tiers and some of the swag.
I got something to show off tonight.
For those of you who are watching on Facebook Live right now or watching the video later, either on Facebook or YouTube later on, Steve is modeling one of the sample new BS hoodies with the Nicaraguan colors.
That's right.
Which is just absolutely gorgeous. So looking forward to those. And then underneath that, I think Steve's actually wearing a prototype shirt.
Easy. What?
Yeah, you're still wearing.
Undressing me with your eyes.
You were undressed when you came out here. Steve's still wearing the prototype shirt for the podcast underneath the BS hoodie. So looking forward to those coming in the near future. So like, share, leave us a review. Tell us what you're drinking, smoking tonight.
Yeah.
Not drinking and driving, obviously.
Well, before I do the audio part, but this is what we are dealing with. I'm going to see if I'm probably out of frame. But for the Patreon patrons and everything, we are going to, as I've been saying, I've already reached out to the patrons so far, but we wanted to have it where you guys get a little thank you gift for supporting us from the very beginning. So this will be kind of factored in as we go forward. If you're a patron for a certain amount of time, we'll go ahead and make sure that we get you one of these based on your size. If you're interested, and we'll do some other swag too. But I'm happy with the way it's a Bell and Canvas shirt. But it basically says, pour one more, light one, light up another. We'll figure this out together, which is basically the summary of our podcast. And on the back, I'm going to get out of frame there, but it's got the logo as well. So.
And notice how Steve was flexing his triceps on that turn.
That's just what happens. That's just what happens. But yeah, so I'm happy.
So what's the shirt say again, Steve?
Yeah, that's natural. That's good lighting.
I'm glad it didn't rip. I was really worried for a second there.
It's just good light. What was that?
What's the shirt say again?
So it says, I got to read it. Pour one more, light up another. We'll figure this out together. So we did some prototype shirts back in the day, and I like the saying, so we're going to go ahead and roll with that for the first batch of shirts. So we'll kind of get more information out there for that. But if you're interested in that, the best way to do it is actually to get on our Patreon page. So it's patreon.com/bourbonandbspodcast, and you can contribute before we put in tiers. But I'm really happy the way it turned out. That is an extra large, just so you know. So going forward, it did shrink a little bit. It's 80-20, but it shrank a little bit on cold and low. Or I ate too much. I don't know. One or the other. So let's get started with the audio here. Hang on. Oh, there you go. Hang on 1 second there. This is why we do this. You may have to restart that GarageBand now. I'll be right back.
You guys talk to the people out there. Ask them what they're drinking.
What's that?
Introduce yourselves.
Yeah. Go ahead, Nook.
I thought we just did that.
Well, it's still, people are watching.
He's here. He's live. We got like 30
yeah.
people.
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Yeah.
I'm Nook from CLE and Asylum Cigars. Yeah. I don't know. I've been down here before. Last time was a little bit of a, you know, the end. End was fun. Yeah. Lost my car keys. Not going to do that again tonight.
Yeah, I heard about that. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Lost them in my pocket. So that was
that's
was
a great
fun.
Time. Great time.
You know.
Well, my name is Nate Blury. I'm one of the guys with St. Liberty Whiskey and the creator of the original Tin Cup Company. And we help market other spirits companies as well. And bourbon and cigars go hand in hand, and we make the bourbon. So it's pretty much.
And he brings
made
the cigars.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good. All right, ready to go here?
Yep.
All right. Happy Whiskey Wednesday, everyone, and welcome to the Bourbon and BS podcast. This is episode 109. I've got some special guests here. We're on Facebook Live if you guys are listening in your car or on your headphones or whatever, to the audio only on Spotify, iTunes, and all that good stuff. We are live now. You can join the conversation on here. But I've got Nook Mercer from CLE Cigars. Welcome, Nook. You're going to have to talk right into the microphone. This is a little different than the last time you were on, I think.
All right.
So welcome. And we have Nate Blury. And he is with St. Liberty Whiskey Company. Is that what it's actually called?
That is what it's called. And then that is our Birdie Bear Gulch you've got in your hand right there.
Yeah. I love the bottle. I can't
thank
wait
you.
To try this.
Thank
I'm
you.
Actually excited about it. So
absolutely.
I wanted to thank for the everyone on the audio. We've already done this on the Facebook Live already in the video. But thank you to our sponsors. We have Tinder Box at Easton, who this is kind of where it all started, right? So this is the relationships and everything else, and a lot of the people that are involved in this. It actually is all based out of Tinder Box at Easton. But they normally supply the first cigars of the night, which I believe in a way we did because Nook was in the store today and he wanted to feature this one.
Yep.
So it came out of the humidor.
Did come out.
It did come out of the humidor.
They
so
will
thank
be replaced.
You. Well, I'm not even saying that. I'm not saying that. But yeah, Tinderbox is decent. So we're going to do the CLE Azabache next. Is that how you say it? Azabache? Or is
yes.
it Azabache?
Yeah. Azabache.
Azabache next. Nate, that's how you say it.
Yep. I always just say Azabache.
Yeah, he says it wrong. But hey, yeah, so that's going to be.
As long as you smoke it, I don't care.
Yeah, right.
Azabache, Azabache. All...
Made by Klee. You know,
Klee, right. Yeah, the Cleveland company.
Yeah.
But no, that cigar, the CLE Azabache, will be 15% off going forward until next Wednesday. So basically until next week's podcast, we're going to have that on special. So that's going to be fantastic. I love that cigar. And then also Altadis USA, normally going to be providing the second cigar, unless we have a special guest like Nook that's going to be very, very generous, and we appreciate that. They're going to be doing also continued support. So thank you all to this USA, Josh and Paul and all the people there for helping us out. Also, BS Cigar Company, I've got an announcement. We have the BS Golds back in. We have BS Silvers arriving again any day, but the BS Silver is from Espinosa. We're happy that we're having all three sizes back in for that. And then also the BS Gold. So what we're going to do is possibly feature the new one here coming up on an episode. It's a reblend. We tried to get as close as we could to the previous company we were working with, and we've had a lot of good feedback. It's all Nicaraguan, and it is coming straight from the Nicaraguan factory of Plasencia. So we're excited about that. If you guys like the Plasencia tobacco, which I think is some of the best coming out of Nicaragua, and it's just a great company to work with. So we appreciate everyone at Alec Bradley actually hooking that up. So they Ryan Ponis and Alec Rubin has been a great help for doing that. So thank you. And I hope you guys check that out. Tonight, our subject is going to be things change. The reason that is, and sorry guys, I'm getting a little wordy here, but for those of you that were planning on coming on Sunday, I don't want to say you have to change your plans because we're still going to be there. But unfortunately, with being in the state of Ohio, Governor DeWine actually brought out a statement stating that addressing mass audience, basically. So it's mass gatherings, and they are going to be saying we can't do that. And so basically the tent's not going up anymore for the smoking tent event, and the liquor permit's not going to be approved. We're basically pulling all that information from us and the permits so that we can't do it. We're very disappointed. So for those of you that are listening to this next week, it's already happened. So you guys are listening to the audio on Monday. It didn't happen yesterday. If you're listening now, what we're going to do is we're going to get together at the Tinder Box and Fado on the patio, and we're still going to smoke and drink and kind of check out all the social media. We'll be sharing more information as that goes. But for those of you that are in different states that are doing this type of stuff, we can talk about it more, but I do hope everyone is taking care of themselves and making sure that they're drinking enough whiskey and smoking enough cigars and
right.
Washing your hands. Doing everything your mom basically told you when you were six, do that. Okay? So if you... Well, the other part, but anyways.
That was your grandma.
Yeah, that's your grandma. That's my dad. Get off my cigarettes. Anyway, so, gentlemen, now that we are we're doing this, things change. It's been a stressful day, but I want to thank you guys for both being here again. And what are we going to start with, the St. Liberty or the we have another bottle on the table?
We're going to start with the St. Liberty. I think that the Knickerbocker barrel-aged gin, that'll pair a little bit better with the Azabache.
Okay.
Awesome.
It's got some good spice to it when I tried it earlier. So we'll go with Nate's St.
Yeah.
Liberty.
Oh, cool. All right,
let's crack it there.
Absolutely.
Tell us a little bit about it. So
I'm excited to. Yeah.
Yeah. So Nate, this is the big thing is we had Nook and I were talking about the fact that it was recently International Women's Day.
Yes.
Which I thought was really
last
cool.
Last Sunday.
Yeah. Last Sunday. And so this was almost a fitting time for you to come on. We recently
Absolutely.
Had a lot of episodes recently that we featured female guests, which was actually a little different. It was never intended that we weren't going to do it, but you want to pour me out there? Thank you. But yeah, we had a streak of female guests, and it was a fantastic run there. And then now we're doing this this episode with this. So this is an ode to.
I love it. And we're coming off from Black History Month, too.
Yeah,
Bernie was a single black woman that homesteaded in Montana.
Okay.
I think what's really cool for us at Pioneer Branded Spirits in St. Liberty is really the idea that we wanted to talk about the empowerment that happened in the Wild West. And it gets lost on a lot of people, but at the same time women's suffrage happened, women got the right to vote, this movement comes across, and in the Wild West... women were really second-class citizens, unfortunately. It was what it was.
Right.
But they were all the ones that were distilling in the saloons. Like, how did the guys in the Wild West get their hooch, as they called it? It was made by women. And so overnight, women got the right to vote, but they also had something that became incredibly valuable. So it's really empowering, and those stories get lost. So we set out to tell these pioneer women their stories. Birdie Brown is the first in the series that we have. This bourbon that we're about to drink right here, which I absolutely love. It's 70% corn in the mash bill.
Okay.
So, I'm sorry. Yes, it is very heavy on the corn. It's 70% corn.
Yeah.
But it's 26.5% rye.
Okay.
And so you're going to see that sweetness. It is a bourbon. But that rye spiciness hits you right on the end. So you get the corn on the nose, but you get that spicy finish from the rye.
Yeah.
Finishes smooth. Finishes quickly. It's not a... something that lingers too long. It's pretty clean, but it is. It's interesting juice. It's its own entity when it comes to it.
It is interesting, and we're drinking out of. Was this clean, by the way? Was this?
Oh yeah,
you
absolutely.
Sure? Okay.
This is the this is the season to talk about it. So yes, it was washed.
Lysol down.
Right, I thought about that after my first sip. I'm like thinking, like I just talked about, like everyone take care of themselves with the coronavirus and everything, and then I'm like, oh, this is really good. I'm going to die.
Yeah, no, it's great. So that's an original tin cup.
Yeah,
they're made from stainless, but that's a drinkware company that we own out of Michigan, and we make everything from scratch. That cup right there started out the size of a dinner plate. We actually hit it so nine times to form it into a cup like you see. And that cup would have been true to the period as well in the Wild West, which is why it's so fitting.
I do like that, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's fun to do. We always tell people, pour your whiskey in your normal drinking glass and then put some in an original tin cup and try it side by side. Most people actually notice a difference.
I'd imagine.
So this really comes about through history, honoring these women, and we've made something that's pretty unique. The bourbon is produced in Austin, Texas, shipped up to Lolo Creek, Montana, where we bring it to proof on the same water that Birdie Brown would have used to still. So she homesteaded by herself as a single woman in the 1800s, and during Prohibition, she had a speakeasy on her land. And so she became a woman bootlegger during Prohibition.
Yeah.
She was known for her hospitality and her hooch, as they would say, their words, not mine. It really is something cool to me to be able to tell her story, to honor her. The bottle is an apothecary-style bottle. It's
true to the period.
Yeah. That's what would have been on the shelves at a pharmacy or something. Mark, the creator of St. Liberty and the guy that's really behind it, the brains behind the operation, he found that bottle off from eBay. It was like a long time obsession of his to find the right bottle.
The shape
of the bottle. It was like a $30 eBay find, and we had to go and get that. It's beautiful. So it's shaped off from an antique bottle of the period.
So
we modeled it, put the St. Liberty on it, and that's the first in a series. So we've got a couple more planned right now. A
couple more.
So we've got a rye coming out soon.
Okay, so this is currently the only offering
The rye is available out west. It's not in Ohio yet for your listeners here. It will be hopefully in the future.
Yeah.
But right now it's available out west. We have Josephine's Last Stand. It's a rye. In honor of Josephine Duty, who is another amazing pioneer woman. It's a green bottle, and it's got Josephine.
That's the one you showed me today.
Yeah, I love the green bottle. And then we've got a four grain coming out, TBD, and that is an antique blue glass, which you've never seen a bourbon in a blue bottle before. It looks really badass.
Was that Bombay?
That's
what I think of when I think of blue.
Sure. But this again, that blue glass would have been true to the period. It's going to look beautiful. It's sexy. And all three bottles lined up, just they all tell a story, and they all have juice to match.
And what's the third one, the four-grain? What's it going to be called?
The four-grain, the
it
name
named
is,
after someone, or is that
yeah,
TBD?
It's TBD.
Okay.
It's a distiller.
TBD.
Yeah, TBD.
It's a catchy name. I like
Tibda.
Tibda. Now, what's her story? What's TBD's story?
Yeah. No, she's from Colorado. We're working with a female-owned distillery in Colorado to produce that one for us, the four-grain. She's going to proof it for us. And that's just got an awesome story as well. That should be out in the summer.
So what exactly is your role with this company? Because you're kind of all over the map, which I can appreciate. You know
absolutely.
What I mean? But it's like,
yeah,
what is
hustle.
Your role with this?
Yeah,
you obviously have some other people involved.
Yeah, so there's a really cool group of guys behind this, and Mark Sorrell is really the creator of it. I guess technically own a tiny, tiny, tiny little percentage of it. Yes.
Okay.
We have a great group behind us. And Dominican Sue, the football player.
Really?
His sister's been involved. We've got Dia Sims, who is amazingly powerful. A woman who helped bring Ciroc vodka to market, and so she's behind this as well. So there's a really huge, talented group of people that are really behind the product. I just get the privilege of talking about it everywhere I go and drinking as much of it as I can.
It's not a bad part of the gig right there.
It's awesome. And then the original tin cup company is something that my wife and I created.
We
wanted to make jobs. We believe that drinkware should still be made in the United States. We do stainless steel drinking straws and cups, our tiny tins. We do a low-ball whiskey glass. And everything is just brought in history, made in Michigan, and really proud of it.
You know, it's funny. My dad was retired, and Nate tossed my dad a little retirement job there.
Yeah,
for a little bit.
Absolutely.
That's when I first met Nate.
Was that right?
Yeah.
My dad told me, he's like, listen, we got to take a little field trip. Just came over there just to hang out and visit. And we went to this machine shop kind of like outside of Holland, like yep, on our way yep. over there, and got to meet and I got to yeah. watch the whole process. And then we went over to Nate's house. My dad yeah. had to bring some paperwork and yeah, went yeah. down in his man cave and
got a cigar room at the house. Yep. It's a great time.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Nice.
And then drank some bourbon and stuff. And then we reconnected probably, last year.
Yeah, over at New Holland.
Over at New Holland.
Yep.
That's right. And, so that's nearby, right?
Yep. New Holland yeah. Is right down from the shop where we produce. And New Holland Distillery is a company that we work with to help bring to market their products.
Okay.
On a sales side of things, on the spirits.
There we go.
They're well known as a brewery. They're one of the largest breweries in the state of Michigan.
Yeah.
And by volume, they're the largest distillery in the state. But we still are trying to help get their name out there in Ohio. Their gin's available throughout the state, and they're available in quite a few states as well.
New Holland also has something else, right? Is that the
tiny little thing called Dragon's Milk?
Well, I know that, yeah. And Nook, you have some, I guess, some connection to Dragon's Milk as well. Are we allowed to talk about that?
We did a cigar in the
you
past.
You did, okay.
And we kind of touched on that the first time I was
That's
on.
Right.
And... yeah, it's kind of a touchy subject right now, but hopefully it'll come back to
things
come back
change.
To
that's
things
the title change, today. Yeah,
you know
things
what?
Change.
Good point.
They gave me the project, and it's been a year and a half almost now.
Yeah,
maybe a little over a year that I've been pursuing this.
I know. And, I know. We've talked about it.
Yeah, a lot of moving parts in this though too.
Oh yeah,
trademarks and all that.
Well, I imagine. Yeah, with all of this stuff, right? I mean,
but you know what? I've made quite a bit of very tasty prototypes.
And you, so, I'm sure you've enjoyed those.
Oh, yes.
Well, we let it go with the barrel, too. I mean, you yeah. get to take the barrels right from the rickhouse there.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Right.
Really?
Yep. Right from right from the Dragon's Milk facility, right across the street, and I get to play with them right away.
Fucking amazing.
And, we had some at Beer Fest in...
Yes, yes, we did.
...in Grand Rapids a few weeks back. So... some good things there.
It is good stuff. And getting back to this, I got to be honest. I love the cups. It takes getting used to drinking whiskey.
Yeah.
With a
yeah.
handle.
Yeah.
I don't. it's
not a Glencairn, that's for sure.
It's not a rocks glass, and I'm not gonna. It's sad, I guess, that you drink or do. Let's take out the drinking. You yeah. do something enough, you get used to a certain.
Yeah.
You know, gesture or movement.
Yeah.
Yeah. I am absolutely talking about drinking. I drink enough where it's like,
among
you know,
other
I,
things,
I,
but yeah,
well, among other things, drink. Smoking a cigar, but
well, we do make a lowball whiskey glass called the Dob.
That's, is it also?
That's a stainless steel lowball metal cup that has no
I'm
handle.
Saying I don't like it. I'm saying it's different.
Yeah, but can you taste the difference? Or do you notice anything?
I actually do. Hang on. I'm drinking for those of you listening.
I think it really helps out with the gin.
Does it? I more of that corn flavor.
Yeah, yeah.
We're out of the steel cup here, tin cup.
It's really amazing. It sort of mutes the front end and opens up the back end a little. It opens that flavor up. It's a lot of fun. We again got to do a lot of experimentation.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's based in history in the Wild West. A lot of the railroad workers would have drank whiskey and the rails and the dynamite blast that was not safe and good for glassware. So they turned to the materials around them, which was tin at the time, and made cups that wouldn't break. Yeah. What got lost in history was the tin changed the taste of the whiskey. And
I think it does.
Yeah, and they actually preferred it. They were just getting poisoned by heavy metals.
Seriously, as I'm taking a sip
of that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very much. We say it everywhere.
This is good.
It's stainless steel.
Good. We're good. Yeah, all right, it's been cleaned.
I've been.
All right, let me switch over to the glass.
I've been to the facility. I checked it out.
All right, well, Nook approved.
Yes.
Nook approved.
yeah, I was just,
why?
What does that mean exactly?
Right. I want to know. So the thing that's I think quite different. Not only the story, not only the bottle, not only the drinking out of the tin cup, is the fact that it's Texas and Montana.
Yes,
that part is unique, and that's one of the things when I was looking at the bottle and reading and talking to you guys and learning a little bit about this.
Yeah,
that took me back. Now Montana. is where she was from?
Montana is where she was from.
Okay.
But the whiskey is produced in Austin, Texas.
Yeah. And it says aged at least 4 years in oak.
Yes. So it's a true bourbon.
Yeah.
It's produced for us in Austin, Texas. And then we bring it to proof up in Lolo Creek, Montana.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there's a partnership there. There's a story to be told throughout the whole process. And really, I think that all of these things are about bringing people together. And so when you sit down for a good cigar, when you sit down for a good drink, you're bringing people together. And this literally, this project's bringing people from other states together. I was saying the Four Grain, that's in Colorado. We're working with a distillery, a female-owned distillery in Colorado to do this. So, yeah, it's all about bringing as many people to the table and letting that creative process move forward.
I'm liking it. I mean, what do you think, Nate? You're sipping on this, correct?
Yeah, I am. No, it's very enjoyable. What's the proof on it?
That proof is 87 proof.
Okay.
Which proof is it's an interesting thing. Which is when you start out barrel proof and go down, everyone has its sweet spot, and it's amazing when you go down on proof and what happens to it. But 82, 86. 90, none of that. 87 is where we landed, and we landed there for a reason because it's just really interesting at that point. It opens it up. You do get a lot of that rye. There's a lot of spice to
it. I'm getting some of that.
And
this is definitely one I think that on a traditional label, they would actually label this as a high rye bourbon.
Absolutely. And, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but 26.5%.
Yeah, but it's so smooth, and the spice that you get from the rye on the back, it's not overwhelming. It's very floral. It's very enjoyable, but it's balanced. The corn, the spice.
I get a little bit of that spice. I get more spice out of the glass as opposed to the metal here.
Maybe I should try my metal cup. Mine's a little different.
There you go. Yeah, I don't know. Yours is no tin cup. I wouldn't trust that, Nate. No, I'm kidding. No, thanks. Those are really kind words. You know, like I said, the whole group of people went into putting that together, and it's really been something cool to see it take on a life of its own, and to see, you know, a product like that on the shelf is I think refreshing. I think that we're coming into its own, but like you said earlier, the idea of women in whiskey, the idea of bringing people together. Is really something that's really cool to see right now. I think we're seeing a change in the marketplace.
Oh, absolutely.
And we want to embrace that. We want to be on the front end of that. We want to be telling stories that other people aren't telling, which is this whole movement that happened in the Wild West.
Was that the driving factor of doing this?
100%.
I mean, I gotta be honest. It's one of those things that I think as you find out about this now. Granted. Seen it on a shelf. Is this available in Ohio, Michigan?
I know it's available. Yeah, it's available in Michigan. We're working on Ohio. We're working predominantly out west right now. Most of the western states, people can get this. You can get it online.
Okay.
Yeah, you can get it online as well. And it's really coming into its own.
I like hearing you talk about it because if I'm looking at this and I, you know, just read an article or whatever, and like these are the people behind this, and it's kind of like, all right, I get it. You know, it's a cool story, almost like a gimmick to set them apart.
Right.
But there's a little bit more passion there, which is, I think, a big part of that. And,
Thank you.
Mentioned there was a couple of women as well involved in
100%.
This process the ownership. So
ownership and on the board of directors as well.
No, I like that.
Yeah. I think that we've been really conscious of the cultural appropriations conversations that people are having nowadays.
Yeah.
And I was dug in. I was ready to talk about it and all of this stuff. What's been crazy, though, is prepared as we were to have these conversations about, you know, profiting off from the story of a black woman wasn't that. It was rather opening up these conversations with these communities of people that are like, dude, what makes a bourbon a bourbon? Like, let me tell you all about that.
You're like,
you
know, what?
I love it. Question. You know, these are the types of things you're seeing culturally. People that you know, their parents and their grandparents, they weren't drinking bourbon. They were drinking, you know, cognac or something of that nature.
Right.
And so bringing it together, opening these conversations is an opportunity for education, to educate bourbon drinkers on history behind it.
Sure.
And to bring it to people that, come from a different background that wouldn't normally drink bourbon, whether it's, you know, women that have interest in wanting to get into it, or, you know, people of different communities that are just like, you know, not used to it. It's just been a lot of fun.
Calls all day long about the Smoking 10 event. We're good back there? Cool. We had Amy Schertzinger from McClellan's Pub, which I still need to return that sign that's behind you. But we had her on, and it was something that we did talk about, that, you know, women in the whiskey world, you know, we had Laurel Tilly on from the cigar world. Nook knows Laurel probably fairly well. And, you know, getting these different perspectives, and it's interesting because you're absolutely right with, as far as, you know, more women are getting into the whiskeys, in my opinion. And I like that because it's same with the cigars. It's nice to see that, you know, half of it, I feel like, if not more, is almost like a hesitation.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's not, because just like any, I think anything, like beer, for example, most likely when people start drinking, whether they're too young to drink or they're in college or whatever it might be, they always say it's like an acquired taste. Coffee, acquired taste. There's, I feel like there are way more people that it's an acquired taste. There's a very few people that they take a sip of whiskey, they take a sip of coffee, and they're like, man, that tastes really good most of the time, the first time. It usually is like, it's not bad, or if they have a certain whiskey. But I think that's something that over time with women, it's starting more and more, just like the cigars. There's more and more people, and I think it's more of an atmosphere thing.
I think so. I think we need to be inclusive and intentional in who we're including at the party, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I always ask myself, what does my friends list look like? If I really want to say these things, do I?
Mine's pretty small.
Yeah. You know, list. I want to make sure that we're an open table, and that's what drinking and smoking cigars brings people together. I mean, that is
really
so
does.
Cool, the conversations, and when you're drinking and when you're even eating, for that matter, these things take all five senses.
Yeah.
You know, there's let's not get into the list. There are things that take all five senses, but this is something that you become really alive when you're just enjoying all of these things, and you let your guard down, and it's just a lot of fun to be around people and socialize. And this was meant to be shared. It's not meant to be, you know, held by yourself.
So, Nook, what do you think of this? And we'll get into the cigar here shortly.
Yeah,
but what do you think of this? I mean, you've obviously had it before, right? And
I've had just a very small amount of it.
Just a few.
I was
sarcasm?
Actually like, no, actually,
really.
Vertically challenged joke? Okay,
no,
that's
no.
Fine. Anyways.
No, not at all.
He's got a cushion on his seat,
no,
though.
No, stop it.
Listen.
I love you, brother.
No, it's one of those boosters, like, you know. So.
Yeah, all right.
I already got one.
Go on.
They did actually have one of those at Target. They didn't have toilet paper, but they had boosters. So I did pick one up.
Don't get me started about that.
But no,
we actually love you, buddy.
I had actually only tried just a little bit of a sample. Nate and I did a Veterans Day event. Mm-hmm. Up in Traverse City.
Yeah.
And at a cigar bar up there, Nolan's. And I was actually there when he got the call about Adamic and Sue.
Make sure you're talking right here.
Disappeared for a little bit, and then he came back, and he's like, nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's like, all right, let's pull out some bottles.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
But no, I just tried just a little bit, and I've been hounding him. I'm like, I need more.
Can you not find it at the store, or you just want to be given a bottle?
I bought this bottle.
Oh, there you go.
He actually did. Right, I now cheers. Owe him a bottle officially.
Yeah, I did buy the bottle.
Thank you for your support, by the way.
Because, you know, in my territory, I cover Kentucky. Mm-hmm. You know, we were sponsors of Bourbon Fest. Like, I'm always around all
That's
the bourbon.
Right.
I was just waiting for the distribution to get to Michigan.
Yes.
And there's a great spot in Grand Rapids I went to on Saturday and picked it up, and they're always busy. I'm like, he's like, you know, what can I get for you? I'm like, I need a bottle of Birdie. And the guy's eyes lit up, and he's like, nice. Very good choice.
Is it moving fast in that area?
So this is crazy to talk about, and the awesome thing. Since we launched, just over this idea has been rolling around in Mark's head for a long time.
Yeah.
When we launched our company, we're less than a year old.
You're less than a year old now.
St. Liberty is. Yeah.
Oh wow.
From incorporation.
Yeah.
We sold over 3,400 cases in the first 180 days of operation.
That seems like a lot.
Making, you know, the government tracks the production of alcohol. They just sort of do this thing, you know, thing. Yeah, it's the fastest growing distillery in the United States at the time. We're blowing up. We're honored, humbled everywhere we look. If you can actually get a bottle of this and you see it on the shelves, I have vested interest to say pick it up, but you'd be lucky. Get it.
It's that. It's one of the rarer ones.
It
in
is.
The area.
It
now,
is
that
just
from
blowing
the,
up.
The supply, or is it more?
So
just
it's
it is popular.
Well, there's a couple of things. It's incredibly popular. The story sells. Out west, they have just really. Really embraced it.
Yeah.
The pioneer culture, California, Texas has been huge for us, Montana. And so they're buying most of it. So that's been an issue. The other part is federally. Montana's a control state. Michigan's a control state. Ohio's a control state.
Right.
And shipping alcohol is tricky, just like tobacco is.
Oh,
we talked about that.
So it's not intentionally held back from the shelves. It's not that we're trying to create.
Okay.
But we've created something that's just, like I said, brought a lot of people to the table that didn't go there before. And so if you see it, grab it, because it's hard to get.
He'll
so.
Tell me right away when it's available in Ohio. I'll get that call. So I
you
got to
let us know,
you guys
for sure.
And,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, because I just found out about some of the other products that that were taken off, and Nate's trying to fight to get some of the Dragon's Milk New Holland stuff back up on the shelves again.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, but we've run into that, like, in the cigar. Like, we were talking about that this morning.
I know. And Ohio's tough.
It is.
Some certain cigar companies, you know, just not, they were just tired of it.
Yeah, so we had that in the cigar world where recently it was tough to get some of the products in because they weren't doing the paperwork side.
They weren't carrying an OTP in Ohio.
Right, exactly. So, they don't do that part because they basically, it's like the checks and balances that you figure that probably most of the time isn't actually happening.
Right.
Where, the retailers send in their paperwork and then the manufacturers and distributors have to send in their paperwork and someone's looking at it, which, again,
probably not
highly unlikely.
No,
most of the time, but that definitely limits it.
Yeah, because I've heard some retailers kind of voice their opinion to me about ordering from a certain company, all the hoops they have to go through just to order. So you tell a customer, listen, you know, your boxes will normally be here within 3 days. Give it a week, two, maybe.
Yeah.
So, but.
But I know Ohio's tough for the liquor side of it as well. You know, it's something that, you have a lot of work to do to get into certain areas. Now, we had Pat Byrne, and then Nate, I know you had something you wanted to mention. We had Pat Byrne and Martin Kennedy on last week, and so they just, if you see Bua, that blue Irish whiskey, the very unique.
That's beautiful.
You mentioned something about, and there's a full bottle right there.
Oh, well, we should
it definitely
maybe
stands
get into
out.
That.
It stands out, and if you notice, the look of how light it is.
Yeah.
Are they UNC fans with the Carolina
No,
blue?
No, okay. They're not.
When was last?
So their idea for the color, when was the last time you saw an Irish whiskey with a blue band? Or blue label. Yeah. Same thing with the BS. When was the last time you saw a cigar with purple?
When's the last time I saw any liquor with UNC? Did Michael Jordan make a,
Well, according according,
go up in price if Michael
according
Jordan
to Pat Byrne, this is periwinkle right here.
Yeah, he said
that
periwinkle.
Is periwinkle.
But yeah, it's
in the mood lighting.
It looks more Robin's egg.
It looks
more
like
Robin's
Carolina
egg.
Yeah. Yeah. So well, anyways, so the thing they were talking about is that and I had a previous guest as well. Rolling Barrel Tours, they came up with the Bourbon 30, which is like Jay Mattingly and all that stuff. They were hitting spots, even our cigar shop. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that because, But anyways, and they were hitting some bars, and they were going to like McClellan's and Fido and a couple other places. They're trying to create the interest. So they have, I guess, the distribution rights to Ohio, but the way you really have to do it is like going around to the different bars. And basically creating that interest so that then they want to buy some, then you can go to the state or whatever. And my understanding is then they can actually distribute to their agencies, and that's how it gets started. And then it's more
a huge process. Yeah.
But you guys aren't even at that point yet. We're, so if you went over to our neighbor at Tinder Box's Fido Irish Pub, if you went in there and they liked it and they're like, okay, cool. Like it's not even on the table yet.
We have to get it through the state approval. Okay. And with the demand that's out west, it's really a balancing act for us. And we want to do what's best. And we want to be in the state, but we have, you know, we have customers out west that have really embraced us.
Yeah.
But yeah, that doesn't mean that people can't look at online retailers, Total Wines and places like that, Wine Warehouse and wine.
David Cox on the feed says, how about Mississippi? Is this in, you know, it's in Mississippi?
That's a great question. That's a great question. I can't speak to that right now off the top of my head. I can message Mark. We'll get an answer to it. We'll put it in the comments. The states that it's, we'll put in the comments once this is done, the states that it's available, and if you don't live in that state, how you can get it. So,
well, you can also, if you want to join from you personally or on you know, the company Facebook page,
yeah,
join the Bourbon and BS community page, and that's where like the conversation kind of continues. So you can post it and kind of say exactly where you can find it, what states and everything else.
Absolutely.
What
do you have?
So I know Ohio and Michigan, you know, both control their prices differently. But Nook, when you picked up a bottle, how much was it? Like what?
That's a good question.
What would this?
$42.95 is we're going to market, and we want to.
I'll take that.
Yeah, we want to keep it affordable. That's frankly is what it costs. But yeah, we want it to be something that again, we want to open it up to as many people as possible to enjoy it.
How much are these cups?
Those cups.
What we're talking about.
Oh, absolutely. $30.
$30.
OriginalTinCup.com. We'll make sure we're adding that community
throw it
page
out there.
As well. Yeah. Heck yeah.
I got the personalized.
Oh. Yeah, you can
this
personalize
was
it too. Nook's got a, yeah, you can personalize
my,
it right on the website.
My 40th birthday present from Nate.
How many years ago was that?
Oh, that was a long time ago.
He just looked at me like, "What the fuck?"
First the height thing. Now it is.
I did see
you've been
in
business for 10 years, huh? That's amazing. You know, did it first for you.
Yeah, I did see one of my buddies actually jumped on.
Cool.
We got a Rich Shooter Smolarek, one of my fraternity brothers from back home in Michigan.
Nice,
so,
nice.
Taught him
Shooter. You know, welcome.
Him. Yep.
Yeah. Sure, welcome.
Yeah, gave him a little shout out right there.
But. That's fantastic. Got a little shout outs. We'll go back to the whiskey a little bit, but let's talk about the cigar.
Yes,
so this is the Eiroa First 20 Years. This was the original release of the 20 Year series, correct?
Yeah, this was to celebrate Christian's 20th year in the cigar business.
Yeah. So I know that when it first came out, it was basically something that he and his father were involved in. Can you tell a little bit of the story? Because like you with the whiskeys and everything else, with the stories and stuff like that, that's what I love about this family. I'm sure you've heard some of these stories, knowing Nook and everything. But
these stories are incredible.
The family history, and then obviously with this particular blend, I love it. And I actually love this cigar, just full disclosure.
It smokes so well, too. It's very clean.
Especially drinking out of the tin cup, too.
Yeah.
Just getting like the sweetness of the corn like on the back end goes really well, really well with this cigar.
You're not wrong.
So
what's the story behind this? So it's called The First 20 Years. You said it's to celebrate his first 20 years in the industry.
It was funny, though. We actually debuted it at one of the trade shows, and it was actually maybe one of the last ones that you and Brian went to.
The only one I've been to 3.5 years ago,
And I want to say we had it on display, but Christian didn't want it going out. It wasn't ready yet. And so it didn't even look like that then. The band was
it wasn't that
the
year
band
then.
Was
maybe it was
no the band was like that, but it was behind glass, and so we went.
I think
ahead
that was
and,
the year because we had picked up a lot of the other like Eiroa stuff,
because
like the CBT had come in, I think at that point. And
I was actually looking online at, you know, different articles and stuff about it today, and somebody actually had taken a picture of that original showing of it at the trade show. I'm like,
okay.
I'm like, it doesn't look like this. I don't even think it was box pressed. So
wow.
But no, that's that's a Mexican seed wrapper grown in Honduras.
Okay.
You know,
at your guys's farms?
Yeah. So like the San Andres, but we grow it in our farms in Honduras. A lot of companies do that for Maduro.
Yeah.
A lot of like anniversary type, you know, takes the box press very, very well. But
is that because it's a thicker leaf?
Yeah. Okay. And I remember, I didn't even know that we grew Mexican tobacco actually at the fields. And Christian and I were walking around the fields one time, and, you know, I know what our Corojo looks like, and with the Habano, the Criollo, and I just happened to look down, and I saw just this massive, like, broad, you know, leaves just sitting. I'm like, what is that, man? He goes, no, man, that's Mexican. I'm like,
really?
I'm like, we grow Mexican? He goes, dude, man, I don't tell you everything that we grow. I'm like, dude, man, I'm sorry. Just ask a question.
Is that common that you grow Mexican in Honduras? I mean, is that what, I mean, because everyone sees San Andres on it, and it's like, I mean, this is just a question for like the everyone that's listening, is that you think, obviously it's like Honduran tobacco or like Corojo, like Honduran Corojo, and it's like, obviously that's grown in Honduras. Like, but when it comes to that, that Mexican San Andres is definitely marketed heavy right now for, for that.
Well, there's a lot everywhere, right? You know, there's a, but there's a lot, you know, the majority is bought from, you know, Mexico and San Andres.
They're growing it there.
But, you know, and there's other companies that make cigars that are very, very popular that have a Mexican seed grown in their own country.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, not naming any names right now.
Yeah. Nicaragua.
Okay. Right.
But,
okay.
So, but, but you can tell the difference smoking a true San Andres from Mexico and then one that's grown in, you know, Honduras or Nicaragua or whatever.
What makes the difference?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Soil content.
Okay. But I mean, as far as flavor, like, I mean, you think you're going to see,
like, you look at like the Azabache. You know, the Azabache, you know, it's got that spice to it, the richness, you know, the fuller bodied, you know, and
then that's a true San Andres wrapper on the Azabache. Okay.
So, and then you smoke the Eiroa 20 year. And, you know, just nice, subtle flavors. It has some body to it.
I see what you're saying.
Why the box wrap? What makes that so?
We get that as retailers a lot as well.
Why?
Yeah, why
this
the box?
This is coming from a guy that enjoys smoking cigars but doesn't know as much. I'm more of I like to learn these things.
You know what? It's just a different shape. You know, and we came out with a cigar, the Asylum 13, the Medulla Oblongata.
Oh, yeah, I love that.
And so we offered it, and it's a round in a box press in the same box.
Yeah.
We just wanted to see how it would sell. Like, you know, what do guys prefer?
Yeah.
And we actually did that. That was last year.
Yeah, at our event. Yeah, at the 10 event. Test.
And we actually took bets of who, you know, because when they came up to the table, they gave me my ticket. I gave them the choice, round or box. And Brian said, hands down, I know my customers, they're going to pick round.
Yeah.
Hands down, they're going to pick round.
A couple other people did as well. They thought that was going to be the popular choice.
I think it was you and I disagreed. We're like, for this event, it's going to be box
press.
Yeah,
I thought so.
So through the first wave of people that came through, box press was winning 2-3 to 1.
Oh, it was, like, we were just blowing it away.
By the end, the last 60 cigars we had left were all round. So Brian came over and he's like, well, why is it? And I was actually I talked to Espinoza.
Yep.
And I forget who was to my left. But when given a choice in the cigar is quote unquote free, the guys are going to pick the box press because in their mind it's more expensive.
Okay.
Like with Padron Anniversary.
Yeah.
Like our Eiroa 20 year. In their mind, it's because I heard these guys say it too. They're like, listen, I do round, but oh man, I just love to get a box press. And they grabbed the box press. Like, we had all these boxes down below behind the table of all the round because we were burning through the box press like crazy. All the round were just back there. So the box press won. But when I talked to Brian and Steve like 3 months after the event. Now what sells in the store? Now it's round. We don't order the box press as much as what the round does. And everybody gravitated. It's more of like how it feels in your hand because you're not really used to, unless you smoke. Well, we got Tyler. He's got the Medulla Oblongata. He's got the in the studio audience. He's got the Oblongata Maduro. But most guys, like, if you smoke, like, let's say, like Padron Anniversary all the time, you know, you know, other brands like that,
they're gonna
gravitate towards Oblongata, like our Prieto and like the Eiroa 20 series. It's a lot of the fill, but it's just funny though too. Like when I do events with Christian, he likes to see. He's like, listen, man, buy them both. See which one you like the best.
The Medulla Oblongata, which I love that.
And it's the same thing. Really, we pull like one filler leaf out to take the box press form.
And so I think we talked about that possibly last time you were on. I know you and I have talked about it, but obviously
because we did both blends last time.
Well, and different companies will say they either take a leaf out or they put an extra leaf in. I've heard both sides of it. Now you say the same thing that Eric Espinosa you mentioned. Yeah. same thing. He pulls a leaf of the filler out. So, like, I like a lot of your guys' stuff. Obviously, I like a lot of Eric's stuff. One of the ones that really stands out with him is the Espinosa Habano.
Okay.
There, his Toro is kind of like like your guys' Medulla Oblongata.
I think his, which one do I like? He gave me some. The Wasabi. That's Wasabi. Box press.
Yeah, yeah. But so, I'm saying, like, the Habano, though, he has it in the round Toro and he has a box press Toro, mm-hmm. and I think it tastes different. Murcielago is another one of his that he only makes mm-hmm. a box press Toro, makes round other sizes, mm-hmm. but then he did a round Toro for us, mm-hmm. and it smoked different. That's what I like, the fact that you guys do that, that Medulla Oblongata, because there are cigars that I love. This is one of them. The first 20 years is definitely one of my top cigars in the last awesome. Several years.
Thank you.
I mean, it's killer. The Colorado I really like as well. A little more medium, more subtleties, but it's very complex. Mm-hmm. But there are times that I want, like Ricky, who is supposed to be on tomorrow night. Unfortunately, he is canceling the trip based on the Smoking 10 event being canceled. Yeah, but we are going to get him on. Don't worry. He's calling me tomorrow. Made sure. But like, he has that CAO flathead.
Yeah.
And when I first smoked that one, he gave it to us. It was a prototype. It had just, like, you know, the white band with a printed thing on there. That's how they all start. And it was like, he had like a Bellicoso, he had a, I think a Toro, a Robusto, and we were sitting around the shop smoking these things. Like, I just want you, and he's bro. You know, bro, I need you.
Yeah.
He's bro. He's one of the guys in the industry. I don't know if you know many guys, Nate, in the industry, but there's several that they use bro a lot in the cigar industry. It comes out a lot. And Ricky, I love him. And Eric's, there's two probably most predominant bro guys. And he's like, bro, I just want to hear what you guys have to say about the cigar. And we're smoking. We're like, dude, this is killer. Like, the initial thing was like, this is like a Liga Privada number 9 killer.
Yeah.
And it was, we were smoking these. And then he's like, cool. Like, that's, thank you so much. And then he releases them. And they're all box press. I'm like, I like it, but I want to smoke. Like, so this one, for example, like the Eiroa First 20 years, I would love to smoke in a round. Mm-hmm. And I think you guys should do a limited edition round. Toro, 6x50s. Yeah. Well, for the Tinder Box, that'd be amazing.
Yeah. How many boxes you got?
Well, so we just got on about, you know, 6,000, 7,000 BS. So we're a little tight. Yeah. And also, we had a change of plans this weekend that we have extra cigars right now.
Well, we did do the.
Can't wait for her tomorrow.
It was.
You keep bringing it up, too.
I can't get it off my mind.
Well, it was a TAA exclusive, but we do have the Eiroa First 20 year Diadema that is not box press.
That's right. Is that available?
Yeah.
Like, widely available? Well, limited edition.
Limited run. Production. Yeah. But, yeah, we do still have it.
Yeah.
I think we have some in stock.
That's funny. You were talking about, you know, with the Medulla Oblongata, one round, one box press. I found in the Robusto and Toro, I prefer the Oblongata and the box press. But on the 60 ring gauge, I prefer
the
Medulla, because the way that box press is on the 60 ring gauge, the top of the cigar, it's very sharp. Edges to that box press, but the bottom side of it is more rounded.
Yeah,
that's right.
So, so it just sits differently.
Yeah.
In my lips when I'm smoking on that cigar.
When I take orders, that's the way that it always falls. Like,
which
I'm just the way that Nate was saying. I probably in Toro is probably my most with the Oblongata,
mm-hmm.
but it's weird now because people forget that we also make a 70 ring, and an 80. In that cigar too, now that's starting to come out.
We sell
more 70s than anybody else in the world.
You make more 70s than anyone else in the world.
So,
chicken or the egg there? You know what I mean?
Listen, man, we weren't the first.
We just
put it out there, but now I've noticed that like Oblongata in the 7x70 is starting to come out there more now too.
Yeah, it's funny the size trends, you know. It's like we had the 660, the 770s, all that, the big cigars going, and then all of a sudden it started like actually kind of teetering back to the classic sizes, and I'm starting to see that again, that it's Nate wants some more whiskey. I'm seeing it kind of go back to that a little bit. But what's the filler and binder on this? Let's get back to this cigar, because I truly enjoy this cigar, and that's what I like that you brought this.
Christian's father put together, you know, a nice vintage blend.
So for the Julio. 20.
Yeah. Christian's father, this. Julio. He gave Christian like a lot of, they had a nice collaboration on it. Like the binder leaf on that is tobacco that Christian had not, the family had not used in just about 50 years. Grown off the original
They're Cuban
Corojos.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's on the binder. You can taste. That's like that sweetness that you're getting is that binder. So like, because I remember Christian's original cigars that he first came out with, you know, back in like the late 90s and everything like that.
Yeah.
And that sweetness of that Corojo, that's what it really reminded me of. And then it's all vintage Corojo within the filler.
100% Corojo on the filler.
Yeah.
Wow. 100%. And you guys don't like go any further as far as saying like, you know, it's you know, this Seiko Viso and all that. Like, I mean, most people don't anymore.
Like, listen, if Christian had his way, he'd put undisclosed.
That's right.
So, but no, everything is our pure 100% authentic Honduran Corojo tobacco.
Dude, it's killer. The elephant in the room with this one, right? And when it came out, this was the way, I mean, from, again, a retailer standpoint, and I think it stands up because this was the original blend, right? The mm-hmm. now is called basically the Maduro, right? Or is this just the first 20?
Just the original, yeah, first 20.
But like when it's sitting in a case or whatever, or boxes next to each other, you have the Colorado mm-hmm. first 20 year. That was the second release. And there's a Connecticut, right? Or no, just those two.
Just those two.
We refer to it as a Maduro, but this is something where people do compare. You mentioned it, I think, in a roundabout way, but Padron.
Yeah.
You mentioned Padron earlier, you know, as far as the anniversary series, the 1926 series, the box press, the presentation. Now, granted, I think you, with the more holographic, I guess, is that what we're dealing with there? There's like a hologram style.
There is.
So I think there's almost, I see the marketing, especially on this one, the shape, the box press, the presentation overall. You have the tissue, which is, I think you guys are getting more and more well known for, the tissue mm-hmm. along the majority of the body of the cigar.
Christian hates cellophane. Always has.
Yeah.
Like when his first Camachos, like when those came out, I remember when I was a retailer, they were all uncello.
Yeah.
Way back in the day.
And that's old school.
You know, and now with everybody's barcoding and this and that and just doing that, taking that tissue wrap and just adding even more to the presentation.
Yeah.
So pretty much everything that comes out of our Aladino factory in Honduras has the tissue wrap to it, which that extends to the Medulla Oblongata line.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, I mean, so the presentation of this one, but I mean, I think there's similarities as far as presentation. And also, from a retailer standpoint, I think it's not necessarily comparing the two cigars as far as flavor or construction or anything
else. It's going to be totally different.
It is, but I think this is something that I think Padron did very well. They have the Padron series, which everyone calls like their core series or whatever, but it's literally Padron series, which is like the 2000, 3000, all those. And then they have the anniversary series, which is the 64s, and you have the 1926s. I think this is, and I've sold it as such, is because I truly believe this is like your guys' answer or almost tribute, in a sense, to what Padron is doing, that you put it out there. It's not a mimic. It's not a copy of it, but it's almost like it's an answer to arguably one of the top-rated cigars historically in recent years.
Like if you look at fields in Honduras and everything, you know, with Christian's father and mm-hmm. their heritage, you know, in Honduras – so, and I've heard a lot of this when I do events, you know, a lot of the big events, and people come up to me and they're like, dude, this is the Padron anniversary of Honduras.
It's kind of my point.
I'll take that.
It's a huge compliment.
Yeah, absolutely. And that
huge compliment.
And the Colorado won best cigar from Honduras at the European Cigar Journal Awards.
Really?
Yep.
Rightfully so. I think it's a killer one. And I do like the hologram because it's not used as much. And I think that, you know, like, for example, like the Cohiba stuff, they're using it in the Cuban line a little bit, like with the Bahiki and everything else. And I think that
I believe Christian uses that same guy. Like I think it's out of the Netherlands. It does like the Opus bands, ESG, and all that. It goes to the same guy to do those bands too.
And I think so. Sometimes I'll give a little bit of shit to, you know, some of the companies like that. You know, where the band you find out that, you know, as far as cost, true cost, it's like. And I don't know what it is on this one, and I'm not really want to dive into it, but when it's like, all right, yeah, the band costs like 20 to 25 cents a band, like cost. And I'm like, it's beautiful. I get it. It's like the boxes, like when they put a box on. This is a more traditional box, but you see these, like the packaging, and I'm like, there's a part of me that is like, can I save $2 on the cigar as a consumer if you just give me a bundle of unwrapped cigars? But it's not. It's the whole presentation, much like.
Absolutely.
The whiskey here. You know what I mean? That's what Christian
you know, talks about. Like, even the vector art, like, we use, you know, the holograms, like, mm-hmm. you know, on our boxes. You open it up, the vector art that's in there. Like, that, it's meant to be put on the shelf.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were putting it in bins. Yeah, we were actually.
Boxes are great. They look great in the back, though, too.
You know, but then we were talking about this earlier with our, you know, with our Instagram content and everything, like showing that, you know, that how we're cutting our cedar, like, you know, the day that cigars are being aged and everything like that. Like, everything just
Nate's saying you have to talk in the microphone.
And it just brings it and just brings it all together.
Yeah.
Like, just write it. I just don't have that deep booming voice.
That's fine. But yeah, it's like you almost have to, you're more like a tennis match. You know what I mean? You almost have to, like, just pivot on that. But
A little bit.
You're right. The cedar, you guys, that's all your cedar as well.
That's awesome. We make all of our boxes.
There's cedar just for you guys that, you know, maybe more bourbon people that are listening to this. But from the cigar side, not everyone buys, especially a cigar like this, in boxes, just because of, you know, honestly, it's not the least expensive cigar. It's nothing extraordinary. You're not going to the $20, $30, $40 range. I mean, you're very competitively priced for what you're smoking. But when you crack a box of, especially in my opinion, the Eiroa stuff,
yeah,
not the first 20 years, your Eiroa, the Corojo, as well as the CBT. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Nate, have you ever seen any of these boxes?
Absolutely.
The cedar is thick. It's about, I'd say, almost maybe three times as thick as
really?
Your normal.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's the normal cedar that you get in these boxes. And it doesn't need, I mean, it's like kind of brittle, and you do like the cedar spills. You just kind of like almost can fold it up as like an accordion.
Yeah.
This is a piece of wood.
Yeah.
I mean, and it might be over here, actually.
Yeah, I see it right there.
If you want to bring it over here.
And even just, like, looking.
And as the guy, you know, and as the guy who drinks a lot more bourbon than smoking cigars, I think the big thing for me, the cellophane, the feel of it as someone who's going to be more of a casual, you know, I smoke for special events kind of guy.
Right.
This is what you want to have. This is what you want to bust out for that special occasion, just because it feels rich. It feels so good in your hands, but the whole experience, the packaging really speaks a lot.
And I think sometimes with the box press on this and all the presentation aside, but when it comes down to it, you take all that stuff off. You know, much like with the Saint Liberty, it's comes down to it, great, gets it off the shelf, people buy it, whatever. But like you always refer, you know, whiskey guys always refer to it as the juice, you know? It is the juice. And with this, it's the tobacco. It's
absolutely.
You guys both have, I think, beautifully marketed products that we're enjoying tonight. But I also look at it as what's in the bottle, what's actually how, you know, what's beyond the band of this is with the box press, a lot of times it's almost like an airier draw a lot of times. And that's not the case on this. It really isn't. This is a firm draw, but it's a beautiful draw. The construction's fantastic. What do you get from the Nate from the front? You say you're more of an occasional cigar smoker.
Yeah, I'm not going to be the everyday guy. I'm the guy that does it for special events, special occasions, and like
So for this one coming in at like say $15 or so,
hands down, worth every penny.
You smoke three cigars a day, $15 is starting to hurt the pocketbook. But for you.
Yeah, this is absolutely right up my alley when I'm thinking of these things, simply because, like I said, it's for that special occasion. It has that special occasion feel. It's still very approachable. It's at like we said, we're not way out on the price point of $20, $30. But for its price point, you get a whole lot.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, again, is the guy that's not going to rotate every turn and does it wrong and stuff. Look at how, I mean, it smokes beautifully. It's wrapped tightly. You know what I mean?
That's funny you say that. Like, I'm not the guy that lights it right, but thank God this thing has training wheels.
That's what I'm hearing.
And he's, you know, like hanging out with me a little bit more. Like, he's getting better at it.
Getting better at it.
But he's holding the ash.
To say that, though, I'll never tap it. But to say that, that speaks so much again to this element of the education piece and bringing people up with that story. And it goes right back to bringing people along and sharing that culture, sharing to the novice guy like me who goes, oh my gosh, when I hear that story behind it, when I learn about all of these things, it opens up to a whole new experience.
Yeah.
And that's how we did the Colorado.
Okay.
It was all that one
was Julio's kind of big thing, right?
Well, he gave Christian a lot of the tobacco just to commemorate Christian's 20-year milestone. Like, a lot of other cigar makers hit that milestone, like, in the same year. I think Rocky did. I think Nick did.
No, I think you're right, yeah.
They were all, like, that was, like, their class.
Yeah.
Their graduating class.
Yeah, they all came in around the same time, absolutely. You
know? And with the Eiroa 20-year, the Colorado, that was something that Christian said, like, he was chasing for, like, the last 20 years in the industry to get... To get that wrapper,
yeah,
like that look. I think, like, how the story went was, you know, his dad made him go, like, overseas, and he was looking at, he went into some cigar shops. I think it was maybe Spain or Germany.
Yeah,
and Cohiba was the big thing then. You know, this is into the, like, the early 90s,
mm-hmm.
and just looking
right before that cigar boom.
Just looking at that presentation, all the bands lined up, like, just. And the color of that wrapper, that nice reddish wrapper, like, just looking uniform. And that turned into Christian's vision for the Eiroa 20-year Colorado.
Dude, and that's a killer cigar as well. I mean, it really is. I mean, Ron Jenkins was saying, love all the Eiroa, but Colorado is still my favorite, a current top 10 for me. That's huge. Nate also, who's sitting in the garage here, I prefer the original over the Colorado. So that's the nice thing about it is I think they're both good cigars. You guys got a great... great lineup, obviously, and just under the actual Eiroa line. I mean, and that's kind of more your premier line, if mm-hmm. I'm not mistaken.
You know, and, like, you know, Tyler's sitting back there, you know, like, when he opens up a box of the first 20, there's no other cigar that smells, you know, so amazing.
You know, I agree, but I think anything that has the actual, not the CLE, like, I'm not saying anything bad about CLE or Asylum, but with that cedar in there, I mean, it's again, as I showed on the video, it's like this is a thick piece of wood here.
It is.
And I think that gives a lot of the, not only aroma to the box, but I think it does really help out the cigar.
It does. Like,
the blends are different, each of them, but I think it gets a little bit of that cedary essence.
Yeah, if you look on our social media too, like we did a video on that, you know, in pictures of the guys bringing in the cedar. And in, like, Christian laid out the step-by-step process of when the cedar's cut, when the box is made, when the cigar comes in. Like, it's down to a science.
Yeah.
Just to get the flavor that they want.
How do you guys think, or, I mean, the I know, Nook, you already kind of said it, but, I mean, like, Nate, like, comparing or pairing this with the St. Liberty and the cigar, what are your thoughts here as far as the combo? Good, bad? You think it'd be the cigar would taste different, or better with, or be better paired with something else other than yours?
Yeah, I'll be the first to say that I have a very vested interest here.
Yeah, that's a fair thing.
I think that there are a lot of Canadian whiskeys out there that are really good that mm-hmm. might come in and play well with this as well. I do really like, and Nook hit on it earlier mm-hmm. with regards to the corn content on the corn side of things, not the rye side of things, that really complements it. The spicy rye finish, though, too, I mean, that adds elements to it. I think, like, a bunch of Canadian whiskeys go really well. I think some good cocktails might go well with it, too, and that's just really where I'm at. Yeah. I might, and this is going to be controversial. I'm ready for comments.
Let's go.
I think that... whiskey on the rocks with this cigar might be something that would
just really, any whiskey on the rocks.
I think on the rocks, that extra element of that cold water, and adding a little bit of water to a Canadian whiskey or something along those lines with the cigar, I think would just make a huge. But that's my opinion. Nah, you know,
that's fair. So, that's fair.
You know, and I knew, like, when we, because honestly, when we signed up for that, Steve and I didn't even discuss what cigars we're going to do.
No.
First time on, I knew I was going to do both blends of the Oblongata. We had that nailed down. But knowing, and, you know, what the birdie tasted like.
Yeah.
And I knew that the one thing stuck in the back of my mind was, like, that sweet finish to it.
Yes.
I knew about, you know, like, the little bite on, you know, on the front end. But when you did... when you do it with the tin cup,
it takes
a little bit of that off, and, like, choosing what cigar went first, like, I knew that, you know, drinking this ahead of time right before we started.
Yes.
That's gonna go more.
Wish I did.
That will go better with the second selection of the night.
What are you referring to for those listening to the audio here? What do we got?
We have the what Nate mentioned earlier, we have the Sealy Azabache.
Right. And then what's the drink though?
But we will be running a special at the Tinder Box until next week on that. So
that's right.
We're gonna do the New Holland, we're going to switch it up. Like, I've been watching, and you did some Irish whiskey.
We did Irish whiskey last week.
You've done some other stuff. So I thought, you know, we're just gonna keep it in, like, the Michigan theme, bringing Nate from Michigan, too. And we're going to do the Knickerbocker barrel-aged gin.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's a lot of the New Holland, their spirits, they're just forgotten about.
Yeah.
Like, period. Like, It's all craft made. Like, you know, the story about, you know, how Brett pretty much kind of fought the state on.
Yeah.
He made it possible for everybody to make liquor, like, in the state of Michigan. And I've toured the facilities. I've been to the facilities many times, like, where they make everything. Like, the regular Knickerbocker gin has won many awards.
Yes, it has.
And you just don't see it. It's a nice, it's a beautiful, you know,
it does not look like gin on this, by the way.
And
yeah, this
so
Nate
can talk more about this.
Because he does
the distribution. But I figured that, you know, tying it into the whole bourbon thing, you know, I was talking with Nate, you know, we were drinking, but then I texted him too. And I'm like, listen,
while
I said.
Together? At the same table you texted
Well, I texted him later on.
Oh, okay.
But still, too, we
got real weird at the table.
No, it was Beer Fest. It's the Winter Beer Fest in Grand Rapids.
Yeah.
Listen,
yeah.
It's Beer City, USA, and we do drinking, and
we
do it well.
Drinking.
Yeah.
I like that.
Occasionally in that city. I'm wearing a better drinking culture shirt right now.
I think that needs to be a new billboard on 96 because they have Beer City, USA. When you're going 96 West,
yeah.
Listen, we do drinking, man. It's
I
want to make that a T-shirt now.
I just when you give your own self a nickname, I think that there's a lot of hubris to that, and to call ourselves Beer City. I mean, I don't know if the name was bestowed upon us. That's one thing, but I'm pretty sure we just sort of co-opted that and like,
I'm shocked that, you know, drinking is a verb and also now a noun. I mean, it's like, what are you gonna do today? Talking to most people, they're like, "Oh, I'm drinking." That's a verb.
Yeah.
Like for you guys, I feel like I'm doing drinking. Like it's just like it's a thing you do. It's like it's not an action.
That's right.
It's just like
damn straight.
What's your day look like today? Drinking. I'm like, you're going drinking? No, I'm just doing doing drinking. Okay. Is that a game? No. Well,
nope.
Sometimes.
It depends. Depends.
Not the way you guys do drinking.
No, ask Nate about Beer Fest.
Yeah, let's not.
So,
all right. Well,
but
with this guy,
anyhow.
But
out of our portfolio, I felt that the Eiroa First 20-year would go the best with.
I think it goes very well. I think this cigar, I've already kind of sung its praises a little bit, but I mean the retrohale on this one, I really really enjoy.
Yeah.
And for those of you listening that are more bourbon enthusiasts as opposed to cigars, I mean, retrohale is basically when you draw it into your mouth, push it through your nose, out the nose, and obviously you blow some of it out of your mouth as well. But it definitely, your nasal passages definitely carry a lot of that flavor. But that, with this cigar for me, is really where the richness comes out.
Yeah.
I mean, it really does. There's like a toastiness to it. I mean, it's just... It transforms. I think it's very good, and I think that's what I like about. By the way, I'm getting used to the tin cup.
You're gonna have to hold it from the handle. You're gonna hold it.
No, I'm saying I'm not. Okay, I was actually saying I'm getting used to. In my mind, I was saying I'm getting used to the flavor out of the tin cup.
Yeah,
and you went originally. You're not wrong because I am still struggling like a toddler with a handle.
We're gonna have to get him a Dom.
We could do it. Yeah, we'll get you a Dom.
We'll get him.
Get him a Dom.
We can put the BS logo on there.
Oh, we might be able to do that.
We might have to do something like that, or the I've got a new bourbon and BS logo.
Do you?
Not the podcast. Not the BS. I'll have to show you guys.
All right, that's
after
awesome.
It's it would look really good on some glassware. Yeah,
there you go.
I think this pairs well. I like this whiskey. I was I gotta be honest, I was a little hesitant.
Yeah,
And I was a little hesitant the first sip I had out of the tin cup because I got a lot of corn. And when you start going away from the traditional bourbons, right, as far as doing it in Kentucky, you know, Ohio, I think especially, I was actually, you guys mentioned Traverse City, and we have that Traverse City whiskey, and and I hear mixed reviews on the Triple X, you know, their basic bourbon or whatever. It actually tested really well on the podcast. I mean, we actually enjoyed it. I'm kind of got this bitter the dark label there next to the Elijah Craig right in the middle. Which is, it's triple. It's just their bourbon. It's they call it Triple X. It's not the barrel proof or anything like that. But now I see it everywhere in Ohio. Thing is that I feel like I've been a little bit. I carry some bitterness towards some of the ones I've had in Ohio originally.
Okay. Me too.
I'm not bringing up any names. All I was saying is
there's
that
some stuff from up north that I was pretty bitter about.
In Michigan?
No.
Or Canada?
In Ohio.
Oh, up north. Oh.
That
Cleveland?
Yes.
Yeah, Cleveland.
I'm not going to say I was at a hotel bar that had...
I'm muted, so I can say it.
That had a vast amount of bourbons.
Yeah.
And they were running a special. And she asked me what I wanted to drink. She's like, here, try this. This is from Cleveland.
Yeah.
Tried it, slid it back. I'm like, I will pay for that. And you can just dump
I'll
it right
for
down
it,
the
but
drain.
I'm not drinking it.
She's like, damn it. Nobody will drink this.
Look, all right.
It was just awful. Awful.
I brought two bottles of it on the podcast.
It didn't go well.
I think we're talking about the same thing.
We are absolutely talking about the same thing. my thing was is that I've got this bitterness because so I was just at a charity event on Friday Arnold Schwarzenegger's charity. After School All Stars, great organization, but they had High Bank Distillery. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that. They're local.
Okay.
And sourcing it. They're about 2 years or so, 2.5 years into their own juice sitting.
Yep.
So they're doing kind of what you guys do. You know, they're looking at the 4 years. They're going to be legit. They have the 53 gallon barrels.
Yep.
And that's what I kind of told them. I said, you know, I've got this bitterness because everyone, like, you know, the companies we've kind of not mentioned, but I mean, I feel like they're trying to recreate the wheel when they're doing this. So that's why when I go into this, like the Traverse City thing, was a Peg Leg Porker. When I see like you bringing this in here, like I'm excited to try something new. And I encourage everyone out there that smoking cigars or drinking whiskey or anything really, like food as well, to just kind of be reserved on your opinions based on the information you have already.
Yeah.
Because I go into this open-minded. Yeah, like I go into this and I'm like, all right, so what do we got? We got Texas, Montana's in the mix. Where's Kentucky on there? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
TX was one that we had as well from Texas.
Yeah.
But I've been pleasantly surprised, and I think a big part of it is, and I'm not saying this is needs an open mind by any means.
Right.
Yeah.
But looking at the info,
yes,
you got to drink the juice, you got to smoke the cigar, you got to do all that stuff.
Absolutely. You can't judge a book by the cover, but to jump
in. You want
in,
to a little bit because you put a lot of effort into the marketing.
But
your cover is beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Well, in addition to that, but to jump in, and I think this is important in depending on where we're at in the community, you know, to all bourbons are whiskey, not all whiskeys are bourbons. And when we really get into this and people really go a bourbon and the people from Kentucky, when I say this, in my opinion, are the ones that'll say it has to come from Kentucky. It does not have to come from Kentucky.
No.
It has to, in the mash bill, the grain mash bill has to be at least 51% corn.
Right.
On the still, when you're going to proof, you can't go above 100. When you're proofing off the still, you can't go above 160. If you do, then you got to go straight up to vodka and neutral grain spirit.
Right.
It has to touch new white American oak, and it has to be in there for at least 2 years. Mm-hmm. Whiskey can be anything else I like this. PBR has a whiskey that's a white whiskey, and that's a whiskey.
I was unaware of this.
Yeah, this is great. This is hilarious. It's hilarious. It is aged at least 4 seconds.
Is that what they say, or is that what you say?
No, it says it on the bottle. Or aged 3 seconds.
Is this just beer?
No, it's okay. Whiskey. Like, but it touches the oak, and then that's allowed to be. It's a white whiskey. Yeah,
these are like oak pipes.
Yeah,
they're just shooting it through there.
Actually, I saw the barrel once. It's got nozzles on both ends.
Oh Lord!
So it shot through it. But so all that to say,
I have to try this now.
Oh, the Ohio rye.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The OYO rye, yeah. On that one, it actually says spent less than a day in the barrel.
Mm. Yeah.
And it comes out, there's no color to it.
No, whatsoever. No, nor should there be.
And it was very different.
Yeah, so the barrel has a lot to do with it. A lot of distilleries, based on, you know, wood contact, they use smaller barrels than the 53-gallon to get the juice to touch more wood sooner and quicker.
Faster, yeah, that's the key.
So there's a whole bunch to it. You know, Traverse City Whiskey, they have to have theirs made for them as well. A lot of places have their stuff made
for
them.
They're sourcing it, yeah.
Sourcing it. But if you...
It's a private label.
Yeah, if you really do... Yeah. Want to put your heart and soul into this, you got to remember that when a company has set out to do this, they have started out 4 years down the road, and they have put their money and tied it up in that barrel. It is an incredible commitment that can't get lost, and it gets lost so quickly by a person online who doesn't have an open mind, and doesn't realize that this company has put 4 years into this. That there's so much that's been put into that and tied into this, and then they it didn't come from
Kentucky,
all
the facts without. Yeah. I don't know. I like blind taste tests, and I think we don't do that enough.
I think that's important, and blind taste tests is huge. I live in this tiny little suburb of Grand Rapids called Byron Center, so we have the Byron Center Bourbon Club, the BCBC, as we call it.
And, BCBC?
The BCBC, the Byron Center Bourbon Club.
So it's all the guys in your cul-de-sac.
Yeah, it's all the guys in the cul-de-sac.
In your cul-de-sac. I've been to your house.
Yes.
I love your greatest hits album, by the way, the BCBC.
But we did a true blind taste test a couple weeks ago back when I was in the state, and it was amazing because in everything that was there was pretty top shelf.
Really?
It really did allow us to have this open mind and knowing that. And then the joke was, oh, is it all the same stuff? It wasn't. It's amazing to see it take on its own characteristics, to judge something outside of the bottle, to take the wrap off the cigar and just enjoy the draw, enjoy the flavor, and just enjoy the way it's brought together. There's something to be said about that.
Yeah.
And I hope more people will do that because there's value to it. If anything, it makes you a better drinker or smoker when it comes to enjoying it, because you're learning blind.
Yeah. We do a specialized event, and I've done about a half a dozen of these events
with Eiroa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Christian comes out, and we do a blind tasting. They get everybody that participates gets four cigars.
Okay.
Just a plain white band, you know, A, B, C, D.
Yeah.
You fill out a questionnaire about the cigar. Like, we list all these criterias.
Yeah.
You know, how, you know, like 1 through 5, you know, draw, construction, appearance.
Rating the cigar at that point.
Everything.
Yeah.
And you sit there and you smoke them, blah, blah, blah. Like, Christian and I, we walk around. At the end, I gather them all up, tally them up. And once we tell, you know, what the cigars are at the end, it comes with a sealed key. And we crack the...
It's very official.
And we crack it open at the end. And we let people know what the cigars are at the end.
Yeah.
And the looks on people's faces is amazing.
You can't tell anyone what the cigar is.
No. But...
I feel like you're on the edge of my seat here. Like, what was it?
But it's a big buildup. You
know what's in the box?
Yeah.
What's in the box?
You know what? I'm gonna let you know, coming to Tinderbox very soon.
Oh,
all right. Nice.
And nice. Christian.
Yeah. He comes with the event.
I love it.
One of those silly Burger King commercials where the guys have the Beyond Meat burger. Yeah. If that was reversed, by the way, I'm just going to step on a soapbox here. How terrible would it be if you gave a bunch of vegetarians a real meat burger? I mean, it's barbaric. Why make fun of these poor farmers?
That would be amazing.
Be a lot of lawsuits.
Eat some meat.
And then they would tell you that they're vegan over and over again. Hey, what'd you do today? I'm vegan. Huh? Cool.
I did see.
I did some drinking.
There was a meme with the coronavirus, and still there is a grocery store all cleared out. The vegan section was still wide open, all shelves cleared. It's a thing. It's really a thing.
Does that mean? No, I'm not going to
do
this.
No.
Does that mean they
were
too
weak
well?
To make it to the store to get the stuff, is what it means.
The toilet paper thing is really bothering me because I'm going to be the one that needs to take a shit here in about a couple weeks, and we're out of it, and we don't have toilet paper. And Liz is my girlfriend. Liz, her response is we have paper towels, and I'm like, that will absolutely destroy everything. You do not want to flush Bounty down. I mean, they're supposed to be absorbent. Like, I like Charmin Strong, right? I like Charmin Strong.
Not a fan.
Charmin Strong?
I do the Kirkland signature with the...
No. No. Dude, get that out of the house. I just blew his mind.
No, I do the...
You're ultra soft?
No, the rib sheets with the aloe, all that, the cottonelle.
Those are like puffs tissues.
Dude, it feels amazing.
I feel like I would forever be unclean. Like, I feel like now it's different.
It's,
yeah.
No, it's amazing.
Point is, before we... All right. You know what? Let's end part one. Go into part two.
Wait, hold on. Wait, is that like Judge Dredd when you had the...
The three seashells. There was a meme going around. It's like,
Yeah.
We need to come up with an alternative. And he's just pointing at it. I'm like, perfect. Man. The three seashells. I mean, I kind of want to know about this.
Me too.
Demolition Man. I wish... Yeah. That was a brilliant part about Demolition Man. Yeah, because it was brilliant because they kept referring to it. And then... They never explained it. That was brilliant writing right there. Still wondering what
it is.
Now
we have to know.
All right. Let's move on to part two here. We're gonna end this. I'm going to go on a rant for those of you that are listening to the audio. Not about just the event. I was going to about Kirkland toilet paper between the episodes.
The Nook's super
gonna
soft.
No. All right. Anyways, but thank you guys. Thanks to our sponsors for part one here. You know, Tinder Box at Easton. Definitely a huge support that makes it all happen. Also, Altadis USA for typically the weekly second cigar, and also for the continued support for this next year. We have a nice sponsorship agreement with them as well, which is nice. And then BS Cigar Company. So the BS Cigar Company. This hoodie that I'm wearing right now, which is the Nicaraguan flag colors, as well as apparently, I didn't even think about it, Honduras as well uses that. Yeah, like Nook's like, excuse me. I'm like... It's Nicaraguan for us because that's the BS Cigar Company. Yeah. All of the tobacco and the two blends is Nicaraguan. So that's why we said it. Nothing against, obviously, anything else. But these will be available. I'll be posting that on like the Bourbon and BS community page and everything else. But through the Tinder Box, we're not starting a clothing company. People wanted new colors and all this stuff. I'm like, hang on. All right. This is swag. It's not a secondary form of income yet, hopefully. But the new gold is fantastic and the silver as well. So thank you for everyone that's been snatching those up. Sean, I know, who's been on the podcast, who's in the garage in the audience. He was jonesing for trying one, and I'm interested to see what he thought. So we didn't talk. He's looking disappointed right now.
I'm not disappointed.
All right, yeah, we'll get into the Smoky 10 event in part two here. So, guys, thank you very much for part one. If you guys are listening to Facebook, we're going to kind of roll right into it here. If you guys are listening to the audio on iTunes or anything else, Spotify, iHeartRadio, definitely check out point two. I really didn't plan on having a topic tonight because but things change, and that's why we're doing it. Yes. So, guys, thank you very much. Nook is taking a break, but let's do a cheers with the tin cups here. I want to hear this here.
Yeah.
Cheers. I like that.
That's good.
Thank you guys very much. Enjoy your week. All right. So here's my thing about Kirkland.
Yeah. Okay. Let's get into it.
So I know Kirkland is the whole Costco brand and everything like that.
There's a signature to the end. It's not just Kirkland. Signature.
All right. It's bullshit. You know, when you do the whole thing where it's like compared to this brand or whatever... There's a lot of times I feel like Kirkland, the Kroger brand, like all these like off-market, whatever it is, I feel like a lot of times, all right, disinfectant, I hope, I'm not taking like a test after I wipe down something with a disinfectant wipe. I just take their word for it. Like I hope that someone's checked this out, right? This is one argument for the FDA. We're not going to get into that either. But my point is with the Kirkland thing is that, you know, Liz went and got the Costco brand stuff, and she's like, it's the same thing as the Ultra Strong. No, it's not. See, the shit's falling apart in my hand. Like, if you're going to spoil yourself on anything, it should be toilet paper.
And with as much Chipotle as you eat, you need the strongest toilet paper.
You need some Chipotle
shakes.
Away. Where?
Chipotle protein shakes. All right, listen, my thing is that when it comes to taking care of yourself, I feel like diet's important, right? getting good sleep.
Yeah.
And toilet paper.
Okay.
Because you
okay.
you want to be clean.
Yeah.
Because it's I can't. I had a friend growing up, and we found this out randomly just in some random conversation in high school.
Okay.
And he basically, I don't know how we got on the subject clearly, but he's like, no, I just do, you know, three wipes and I'm done. And I'm like, whoa, what if it's not, what
you
if it's not done
him,
down
right?
there?
You
like,
unfriended
I mean, like,
him,
you know,
right?
Like, it's not a, this isn't a number thing. Like,
you just think
itchy
ass cracks are normal.
Oh.
Oh, I don't,
All right.
We went there.
Sometimes you got to go name brand.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
No, I think toilet paper is one of them.
And I'll submit
Should
to
be on
the
top
paper.
Of the list.
But I will, I'm going to name drop and raise you Kirkland vodka.
We can't do that here. What? I don't think the Costco's don't do the Kirkland Scott. They have whiskey, they have vodka.
Oh, Kirkland vodka, it's like $11.99 for, and I call it the glug glug. My wife hates it. It's so good. It's awesome stuff.
I love people tuning in right now after that conversation. David Cox, this just took a bad turn.
It did. It did. It was the three wipes thing, but, Jesus, but you know, we went there. No, that
was- you missed a oh, lot of the toilet paper conversation.
Yeah, there was a whole toilet paper
thing. I had to pee so bad.
All right. Did have to, you know, do the number two, there's Charmin Ultra Strong. There,
which,
so.
Yeah, I'm just not rich enough. We're small business owners, so we're Kirkland budget life. We're not high budget toilet paper.
At the Tinder Box, we've got the members mark from Sam's Club. I don't enjoy it. It says 2-ply. That's horseshit. It's like 2 half-plies, which would equate to 1-ply by math, even if there's 2 of them put together.
You got to kill that bottle. We're on to bottle 2, so you got to make sure it's gone there, bud.
Yeah, and Taco Bell should have an agreement with some like Charmin or something like that.
Well, like I said, the Chipotle away, Billy Mays, rest in peace, in South Park. It's a whole episode. It's
Before we get into part two, let's pour a couple more drinks. But Doug Ruffalo says, Steve, did your friend use both sides of the paper? I hope not. Because at that point, what are you touching? With your hand.
You know what?
This is why we're supposed to wash our hands. That's how you fight
that
this virus.
That is not why. Using both sides of toilet paper.
Oh, I hit
paper.
The table. I just blew Nate's ears out. Sorry, guys.
Only 10% of toilet paper is actually used for what you use it for. The other 90% just to, so that way your hand doesn't touch it.
I was living with a friend. And
this is really, I'm so excited to
I
have
don't know
this
why it went this way, but you mentioned Kirkland. It's a short fuse.
Hey,
me.
It's great. It's great.
I had a friend I was living with for a short period of time years ago. And I don't know how these conversations come up. The toilet paper conversations are not normal, I don't think. They're not like every day.
It's coronavirus. It doesn't, yeah, it freaks us out.
You should hear of my conversation
some point,
with Michelle from our company.
I said that I have to use, I think he was buying the cheap shit too at the time, right? And I was just like, hey, you know, like, I'll buy the next round of toilet paper because this stuff's so thin, I have to use extra. Like when I wad it up, and he said, he's like, whoa, you wad? He's like, I don't have that kind of money. Like, I'm a fold guy. I'm like, wait, what? Like, there's a lot going on in the bathroom that people don't talk about enough. I
gotta
be honest. Toilet paper is one of them.
So hard, I almost spit my
whiskey. The over-under thing is just the fucking tip of the iceberg. Like, I gotta be honest. That is just the fucking tip of the iceberg.
Listen,
you want to weigh in on this?
Yeah, I actually do. This is something I'm actually an expert on. Because I spend a lot of time in the bathroom. I just have a bad digestive tract, and right. You know,
IBS.
You know, I have some allergies, and okay. I developed them later on in life, and I don't want to accept that I have those food allergies anymore. So I just keep eating the shit that I'm not supposed to eat.
Smart.
That's
smart.
That's what's happening. But
double cheese sticks.
But this morning was rough. I kind of told Steve about this earlier on.
We
today.
Didn't have that in depth of a conversation.
And yeah. It was
you had the hot, like Chipotle, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm kind of like lactose intolerant. There's certain lactose things I can have. Okay. I guess it depends on the fat in the dairy content.
Okay.
That's what it
Organic
is.
Organic cows.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So that's why I drink all Fairlife milk. It's fine. Blah, blah, blah. Jet's pizza is fine. I can eat that.
That's amazing.
Because it's the fat content of the cheese that they put on the pizza.
Okay.
Anyhow. Had to go rock out some Chipotle because I'm in Columbus last night, and I had a lot of that fire salsa or whatever they put on.
Hot,
there.
Just the hot, right?
The hot.
So
it was bad this morning, but still, like
you guys have been really gracious to me.
But it's just wrong with like the toilet paper in the hotel that I had. That's why I carry my Cottonelle wipes with me.
Oh my!
Oh, geez.
Like,
are you?
Sponsored? Are they a sponsor? You know, yeah, are you like, making money?
And you then, know what, man? Because that is the best.
Slow down and talk
that's,
about it.
That's the way. Listen.
Somehow that zoomed in on him when he said that. I don't,
listen,
I don't know.
That's
who's
the way you play
this.
Cleanup duty, right there. You use the regular, and you just come on home and. You're
so
good
guys,
to go
I'm,
after
I'm
that.
Not a, I'm not. No, I'm not a wet wipe guy.
You guys have been really gracious to me since
you
I'm not an
that?
Everyday cigar smoker. You brought me
here
up to speed on some things. Plus, I need to know Columbus and Chipotle. Is there a thing here? Is Chipotle like headquartered in Columbus, or
no,
is
it's
just
huge.
A,
no,
it, okay?
It's
I just don't
Steve
know the Chipotle
too.
Culture
plus,
of this region.
It's next door to the Tinder Box.
Steve is sponsored by.
I wish.
We're not really going to mention. That's like in the fine print of the podcast. Steve is sponsored by Chipotle.
I wish.
God, I wish. They did just come out with queso, by the way. After
again,
all of this,
because the first
time.
One was shit.
That was
Nate,
bad.
What do you got?
That was bad.
Before we need to roll into the actual.
Well, I was going
to
get back into cigar talk real quick.
Yes,
I thought you were getting back into TP quality.
Start
quarter,
but... this...
All right, we can.
So you want the in between? Go ahead.
Well, Nook, I remember the first time you were on Nook, you were talking because when Steve was talking about the cedar and how you guys actually grow your own cedar trees.
I like how you brought this back.
You had talked about that's how, like, Christian's Farms, there's, like, zero waste.
Yeah.
Or something to that extent. Or, like,
zero impact.
Zero environmental impact. Like,
zero impact.
Like, even any of the chemicals that you use, they're all...
It's all
eco-friendly
and
food-grade stuff.
We're all Bayer certified.
Yeah.
And which takes, I think...
which is...
Those guys actually came to our sales meeting. I didn't understand anything they said, but I think it's, like,
but
6 years
out.
To get, like... 6 years to be Bayer certified. We're the only tobacco company that is Bayer certified. Like that's the same thing that like Tropicana,
Dole
goes
right.
through.
Yeah.
So, but everything that we use, all the pesticides, everything is food grade.
Yeah.
Anything that you'd use on fruits and vegetables, we're the only company that uses that on our tobacco.
So what's funny is about a month after you were first on the podcast and talked about that, I actually had a young couple come into the shop and they're like, yeah, so are any of these cigars organic?
God damn it.
And I was like, well, here's the closest you're going to get to that and here's why.
That's
and so when you were talking about the cedar and like you guys actually grow your own trees and cut them down and you make your own boxes and everything, that's what reminded me.
You know, whatever Christian cuts down, like whatever zero impact, we're going to replant.
That's
so cool.
It's, you know, everything is given back.
I would encourage people to go to the website, your social. There are some online videos.
Yeah.
The Eiroa stuff, right? Yeah.
And I would encourage people, especially anyone that's listening, to check those out because
absolutely.
Those videos are amazing. They really do tell the
thank
story
you.
Well. And I'm pretty sure you're even in one of those.
I am. Well, in a most recent video from January, I was thrown in a pool in one of those.
Oh.
But
I didn't
oh,
see
I'm
going to
check
one.
It out now.
Yeah. I didn't
oh, wait.
See that
is that,
one.
That's not the one you were talking about?
I don't know. I was going to do a short joke
anyways,
about how it's hard to see you.
No,
weren't
was,
we supposed to have
no,
the,
I was actually in that one. But.
Weren't we supposed to have the CLE pool party in the summer?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that was in the old house, though.
Yeah. This, yeah, it got...
Sean's pulling up toilet paper memes. Don't get me started again.
Whoa.
All right,
listen,
this.
Man. Dude.
Let's roll into part two here.
I'm going to be on this. I'm going to go on the record. Cottonelle with either the purple logo...
You like that quilted thing.
Or... Yeah, but that's got the ribs, or the green
condom.
That
Jesus
has
Christ.
The, or has the
what
aloe.
What are you doing with this?
Listen, that's the best TP you can buy. I do take toilet paper from hotels when I have a lot of people over. You will get the guest toilet paper, and that's the shit that I'm taking tonight. That's the stuff I'm taking from tonight.
I never thought about taking toilet
that's
paper
the,
from hotels.
That's
this
from
is
the,
great.
Well,
now people are probably doing it all the time with
you
the
know
shortage.
I've missed out so many opportunities now.
Extra.
You know what? I was talking with – I saw Sam Smirkle's post about that earlier today about toilet paper shortage. And I said I would – Tom Lazuka, which is the – people don't know. The you know the co-creator of Asylum.
Asylum, yeah.
Mr. Asylum. We were traveling earlier on in my career, and he asked me, he's like, listen, man, dude, did you grab the extra roll in there? I'm like, no, why? Why would I take the toilet paper from the hotel? He's like, dude, man, that shit's fucking expensive, man. I have three boys in my household. You have to take the toilet paper. So
women are
like,
worse.
All right.
Women are worse with toilet paper. When you start living with a girl for the first time, you're just like, where did it go? I'm not wrong. All right, let's.
But I have taken the shampoos and all that other stuff, and I've donated them to homeless shelters. And,
that's nice
and
of you. All right.
But the toilet paper, that's yours.
Oh, that shit's mine.
Yeah.
Nice.
That
nice.
Shit's expensive.
All right, I'm going to start the second part here, guys. Yeah. Hang on.
Ready to go. Be all proper.
We might have to do another cigar here soon.
Let's do another cigar. Welcome back to the Bourbon BS podcast. This is part two. So the first part, we had some great St. Liberty whiskey. It's the Birdie Brown, or Birdie's Bear Gulch, named after Birdie Brown. Fantastic product. Unfortunately, if you're in Ohio, where we have a lot of listeners and several other states, it's not available yet. But it is something that if you guys can find it, definitely seek it out. We've enjoyed it. Drinking out of the tin cups from Nate here, who is representing the St. Liberty, as well as the tin cups that we're all drinking out of, which is very, very cool. And I'm actually getting the handle better here. But I want to thank our sponsors, Tinder Box at Easton, for part two here. They normally supply the first cigar each week, and we are going to be featuring, I think we're going to be lighting up the CLE Azabache, right, next. Azabache. So that's going to be 15% off going forward between now and next week's episode. So if you guys are in the area, stop by the Tinder Box. If you guys are elsewhere, we can ship a minimum of 5 for 15% off and plus shipping. So hopefully you guys can take advantage of that.
Sunday.
We're going to talk about Sunday. Also, Altadis USA. We are going to Altadis. I appreciate he's got this. We're going to get into the topic, and that's going to involve Sunday. But Altadis USA, thank you very much. Normally, the second weekly cigar, and they have been a huge support of ours, and we appreciate everything that you guys have done for us and continue to do. So, also the BS Cigar Company. If you guys have been listening, we have had a lot of hurry up and wait on the BS Gold. Now that is back in stock in three different sizes, 552, 654, and 758, and it is 100% Nicaraguan tobacco. We blended with Plasencia tobacco this time around, and we couldn't be happier. So we're happy about that. It is.
Had it this morning.
And we also have the BS Silver in all three sizes shortly from Eric Espinosa, which is a little more peppery. We enjoy that as well, so definitely check that out. Also, the Patreon page. So if you look at the video, we're going to take some pictures of it as well. We have the T-shirts, so all the early patrons are going to get their own very own Bourbon and BS podcast T-shirt. And on the front it says, pour one more drink, light up another, we're going to figure this out together. And that's kind of the whole thing about this podcast. Yeah. That's where the saying comes from. So I'm happy with the shirts, and I hope you guys are as well. So check those out. If you're listening to the audio, check them out on either the Bourbon and BS podcast Instagram, once we get it posted this week, the Facebook, or also the community page, which is how you guys can stay involved in the conversation. Also, if you guys want to contribute, we're going to be throwing up tiers as well on the Patreon page. But I appreciate everyone jumping on there and supporting it. It's definitely making this easier on me and everyone that helps support this as well, as far as providing us to be able to do more options. And we're going to have some changes, I think, coming up with as far as the video where we get most of the traction. So I'm looking into that, and I'm going to be talking to Dustin and Nate as well about what their thoughts on some of the things that I've been looking at as far as upgrading what we're doing here, so as far as the presentation. So that all goes into it, so I appreciate that. The 10 event, Nook was talking about. Sunday, for those of you that have been following along, we had the Smoking 10 event was going to be this Sunday, March 15th. Due to the coronavirus pandemic, as it's been called now at this point. In Ohio, there's only been 4 cases, no deaths. But at this point, the state of Ohio is making in the next 24 hours, I have not been looking since we've been recording, but next 24 hours or so, they're going to be making a official government order as far as mass gatherings. And that's where we and our partner in the event, Fido Irish Pub and Restaurant here in Columbus, Ohio at Easton, They're not going to be able to put up the tent. They're going to get their liquor license permit revoked for that event. And we get it, and we're disappointed. So I put out a statement before doing the podcast tonight. So if you guys are listening to this live, or if you listen to it, hopefully I'll get it posted here on Friday at the very latest. This is something that Sunday we've got a lot of our guys, like Nook, that they're still going to come around Sunday. You know, Brian, Joyce, myself.
10 days on the road, baby. I'll be
10
here.
Days, baby. So Sunday, we are going to, we've been committed the entire Fido patio. It'll be an honest surprise and pleasure if we are overflowing that patio and we have that problem. That'll be a good problem to have. But this is an opportunity. So we're going to either be doing refunds if you guys want to do that. If you want the cigars, we can work that out. Just contact us. Read the email. Check out our social media. Got all that information out there. But in the meantime, if you guys want to take advantage of not only getting your cigars, if you still want to do that instead of a refund, if you want to take advantage of that killer menu that Fido Irish Pub and Restaurant got together for us, they already bought the food. So if you guys want to, instead of a refund, come hang out, smoke some cigars, meet Nook and a lot of the other guys. Unfortunately, a lot of the quote special guests are not going to be in town anymore, yeah. Which I get. I told them. I told Nook about Christian. I was like, we don't know what to expect at this point, so go home, be with your family, and we've invited everyone to still come up. And we've got guys like Nook and other companies coming around still on Sunday.
And if you guys come out and buy our packs and, you know, in addition to all the other good cigars you're going to get from us, whether you're VIP, regular admission, dude, we went all out this year.
Yeah,
especially with our VIP package. And
I just wanted to
love for Christian to be there to give the VIP guys their cigars this year, but it's not going to happen. But if you guys do come out, just come see me, loaded with swag. We're going to make this worth your while. Like, come out, support CLE, Eiroa, and Asylum. I'm going to make it worth your while on Sunday. Listen, I'm here for like five, six days in Columbus. Ooh, I'm gonna blow
let's
it
make,
up.
Let's make it happen.
I'm not gonna cop out. I'm not gonna go home.
Yeah,
because I'm doing something on Friday, nothing on Saturday. I could go home. I'm gonna stay here Columbus. I'm gonna support the shop, and we're gonna rock the shit out on Sunday.
Well, I think everyone's disappointed in it, and in no way. And I'm gonna go on social media tomorrow and everything like that. But in no way is this the replacement. The 10 event is canceled. This is just, we got to move forward. This is the topic tonight, and this will lead into it, is that things change. And with the Smoking 10 event, I'm not. We thought about trying to call an audible. We didn't want to put on a bad event. So this is our situation is that we've got the cigars. Fido has the food. Sunday is happening regardless, and nothing else changes. We can still hang out, smoke, drink, eat some good food, and we have all the cigars for the specials as well. And you got guys like Nook that have swag, so we're gonna be able to do what we can. So that's an option for everyone to come on out on Sunday to the shop and to Fido. I'm gonna be there starting. I'm be on the patio the best I can, and starting at 10:30, I'll be at the shop before that. But I'm still gonna have a good Sunday. It's kind of like 2 years ago where we had an issue where I basically raised the glass and I said I'm not gonna let this ruin my day, and that's the way I look at it as of now. I'm basically, this is where we get in the conversation, right? So things change, right? When I'm thinking about this, we weren't going to do a topic tonight because we were going to be doing we had Ricky just Rodriguez tomorrow
play.
Night. Yeah, free but I mean, today, it's you know. The way my mind thinks. If you get a couple whiskeys in you, it's well, we had Ricky Rodriguez tomorrow night. We're supposed to do two podcasts this week, and now that we canceled our event, and I feel bad because he was going to be at another shop here in town, Ed, at Woodlands, which is still going on. Woodlands in Delaware, Ohio.
Friday
night, check it out.
Woodlands Cigar Festival.
But good Ricky time. Basically, you know, it doesn't make sense for him to travel with all this shit going on as well, so right. He's like, you know, I'm going to cancel my whole trip. We're going to get him on the podcast. We're going to get to do an event with him here coming up in the next upcoming months. I'm talking to him tomorrow. But it's I had to get on the phone. Not only is like when you're dealing with this, trying to do this whole cancellation when things are out of your control and things change. This is what I'm thinking. Like literally, I was getting to this point. I don't know if you guys can relate to this as far as when it gets down to like business or also like relationships or just shit in general. Man. You get a bad diagnosis. Like the doctor tells you something that you don't want to hear. I felt like I was fighting back rage. I was fighting back tears all at the same time. Like I'm talking to guys like Nook on the phone, and I felt like I was like breaking up with 11 different people back to back. Like I was choking up. Like it was miserable. I felt like I was calling Nook and a bunch of my other friends and telling them that, you know, my girlfriend left me.
Yeah.
Or you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like that was the level of initial knee jerk reaction when when we're listening to this type of stuff, and when this happens, and the things out of your control, it's like you can will it, you can be angry, you can just do everything you can in your power, but when it comes down to it, it's like you don't have that control.
Yeah.
And the things that changed were, we spent all this time, I spent all my time trying to do all this stuff, get all these people together. We had 200 to 300 people getting together.
Yeah.
And then something bigger than us, with whatever's going on, and we can talk about it if you guys want. I don't really want to give my political review or opinions on this, but I it's just, this is what's happening. This is the cards that you're dealt.
Yeah.
And so
we'll leave it at that.
Yeah, dealing with this stuff, it's the cards that were dealt. And so dealing with this is like you make a decision, and now it's basically everyone gets it, but it doesn't make it any better.
Yeah.
Right. And so, and then on top of that, obviously from the business standpoint, we're dealing with this, and you know, we had all this set up where it's like, you know, I got in these two boxes over here, I got 300 hats that we did custom.
I saw those this morning.
Custom for the event. And now it's like, all right, so we want to give people the cigars that they paid for. We want that. The biggest thing is we want to give them the experience.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, again, it's kind of like that relationship. It really is like a breakup where someone gets to you at that point where it's like you have all these plans for the future and you have all these aspirations that this is going to happen, and then all of a sudden it's just like the rug is taken out from underneath you.
Yeah.
And it was like when I was laying in my hotel room, like just watching TV, I saw all that stuff hand. And I was in there this morning, and we talked about all this too.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, like I feel it's coming.
Yeah.
Like we talked about basketball. We talked about all the other events being canceled.
Yeah.
And I saw your name pop up on my caller ID. I'm like, fuck. I'm like, dude, I know I have to be there at like, you know, like 6:30 tonight. Steve never calls me.
You knew I wasn't going. I text you, but you knew I wasn't calling about the podcast.
Right.
Yeah.
Because Steve only texts me. And I'm like, if you call me, if you're only a texter, it's something important. So I'm like, all right, I got to call Christian.
I wanted to text blah, blah, blah. Everyone.
I think, and can I,
so,
go on.
You know, and it was like, all right, well, not for certain yet, but I'll call you right back. First one I'm calling, let me call you right back.
Mm-hmm.
Can like, I guess Fido just came in and was talking to you.
Yeah, I mean, we were making the decision, then it's like, Fido, like, again, our partner in this event, we co-op with it. And, and you know, obviously they're dealing with it. They had two events in town, both in Dublin first, and now this one, they canceled.
And then when you called me back, I'm like, all right, so, all right. And then I just started thinking, I'm like, listen, I could jump out.
Yeah.
I'm like, listen, I got Ed's event, you know, and I could stay there and just bolt. I called Christian. He just texted me back like real shortly, but he was with another rep and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But then he called me back. I told him, and you know, we started talking for a little bit.
Yeah.
And I'm like, listen, and I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, and I was going to ask Steve this tonight. I'm like, listen, who's staying here? What reps are coming?
Yeah.
What primaries are coming? I'm like, listen, we're going to band together, because after all the stuff that Steve told me, like, listen, it's going to be like a summit of reps. So whoever's left standing, like, I decided I'm going to keep my reservation here. I'm going to stay here doing Ed's event on Friday. I'm keeping my event. I'm in, keeping my hotel reservation Saturday and Sunday. I'm like, listen, find out who's here. Dude, we're going to blow it out. Like,
I hope
we
people
have,
come out just to hang out.
You know,
honestly.
Like,
like, what else are you going to do? You had plans.
We have limited space, but you know what? Let's set up Rep Central.
Yeah.
And we're going to fucking do this shit up.
I love
we're gonna act
it
up. Dude, I'm gonna bring out my banners. We're gonna fucking wreck shit up.
Yeah.
I do want to say this.
Because you have all that product that you guys got, and we're gonna make that shit move.
Talking more,
we're gonna make it move, man.
The big thing was, and I appreciate that, because the big thing was is that it's not necessarily like, it's a business thing, but this has always been like a customer appreciation.
Yeah.
This is 8 years doing it. I've been with Brian now, I've been in this business now for 7 years full time, but even the first one we were talking about doing prior to me going full time.
Yeah.
I was just like helping, you know, Brian out with a couple hours a month. I was doing another gig and all that stuff, and it was one of those things that ever since I started in this industry, this was in a sense, I felt like, I mean, obviously everyone helps out and everyone does their, but I felt like it was like my baby. And so that was one of those things. Like today, I mean, like 2 years ago when we had the fire department come in, unbeknownst to us, we were doing something wrong after 5 years prior. You know what I mean? Right. So it was like 6 years in. They're like, hey, yeah, this is happening.
Yeah, yeah.
No, it was literally like, it was, what we did, but it was like smoking in the tent. And it's like, that was an issue.
Yeah.
So then last year, we basically tried to go through all the hurdles, went through all the hoops. And Nate, you don't know this, but it's like, I started the conversation with them or emails at that time in August, but then I didn't get any real answer until October. And by the time they gave us the green light, now all of a sudden we're competing with Ed at Woodlands, which we mentioned, which I hope everyone checks out if you're in the Columbus area. I mean, this is a great opportunity to do both still. We should still have a good weekend. But it was one of those things where it's like, all right, so now we're doing this, and it's not quite what we wanted to do. This year we're coming back.
Yeah.
And now it's – once again, out of our control. That thing's dead.
It's done. Shit. On to the next.
We gotta
Steve,
go to the gym.
I do want to say this as someone who's just sat down at this table and we're talking about how things change.
Yeah.
And I want to echo this. We got to look in our lives at the things we can control and the things that we can't control. But I want to – what a huge testament to this. And I didn't want this to go through and just be passed.
Yeah.
The idea that you took the time to call and not text. And I know it was easy to text bad news. That stands to so much character to say, hey, I'm going to actually take the time and call. And I know that this sucks, but the thing that we can control is how we respond.
Yeah.
And the way you have chosen to respond to this is so admirable. It's so big that you would take the time to call everyone, that you would take the time to say, listen, we're going to do what it takes to make it right for the people that have bought tickets, but also we're going to continue and we're still going to party on this deck. And to me, I just want you to know that, like, as someone who's just coming into this, I commend you for taking the time to actually call people, not just text, not just blow it off. It's so hard. It stinks. It really sucks. But there are things that happen in life that we just can't control. What we can control and what we can't control. And when we figure out what the difference is between the two and how we react to it, is that makes all the difference in the world. And that's what separates men from, you know,
the boys. I mean, and that was one of those things when I went over and talked to, and this is just, and anyone listening on the live feed, if you guys have anything that you want to add to, not necessarily this specific part of it, but if you got something else that's been suspended?
Yeah, we've got other events. We're just finding out.
Like,
same type of thing.
The thing is, like, Nate and I were talking about earlier, like, we have one big event in Grand Rapids back home, and Irish on Ionia.
Yeah.
That's a big thing, and Nate has his bourbon.
Yeah, we have the Grand Rapids Bourbon Festival. We were on a call today about how we handle it.
And Nate, like, during the call, everything was good, good, good. One of my friends back home, she just texted me. She's like, Irish on Ionia has been suspended.
Yeah.
Just saw it on the news.
Yeah. Wow.
So, yeah, it's
That's I found myself the last several days feeling as though I was being insensitive to what's going on, because there's a little bit of, you know, not, again, I don't want to necessarily dive into the politics of it, but it's like, there is a scare there, you know, all this stuff is going on. And I think that there's a fine line that we have to walk when things aren't going well in life.
Yeah.
And I'm not just trying to belittle, obviously, the coronavirus thing and all that stuff, but it is one of those things where, with it being out of our control, we are a little everyone's a little selfish.
Yeah.
Everyone's a little selfish, if not more. And it's one of those things that it's like, it's not just about, like I said, making money. It's like, people are looking forward to this stuff.
Exactly.
And as trivial as it sounds to some people, it's like, well, it's just basketball. Like, who really needs to go to the Final Four or, like, the March Madness stuff? And it's like, this is an escape that is a proven, not only business, but it's a proven thing that people enjoy doing this.
Yes, yes.
Like, so these events that we're talking about, I mean, we look at this stuff, you know, again, like, in this household, Liz is not only, you know, back in school, but she works in the service industry.
Yeah.
And I'm in retail.
Yeah.
So, and you figure if all of a sudden these sweeping changes go through, and now it's like, all right, so we're going to be all right, but, like, how long?
Yeah.
You know, how long? Like, you know, and it's the frustrating part where you feel a little selfish when things outside of your control really start changing, in my opinion, because I look at it as like, well, we could have done it and nothing may have happened. where the other side of it is like, well, if nothing changes, then something bad could happen.
And exactly.
It's a scary thought, and I am a selfish person, just like a lot of people, most people actually, when it comes to this, is that I would feel terrible if something would have happened in any of these events. I'd feel terrible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you've got a lot of other people that are being involved, and I get the mass gathering thing, but it's like, yeah, when I look at these situations, just in life in general, it's hard to put your priorities second.
Correct.
And it's not always ill will. It's not just like I'm better, or it's like an ego thing or anything like that. It's not none of that stuff. And that's why I keep, like, you know, my mind, you know, it was like thinking about this tonight. I didn't really want to do a topic, but it's like, all right, now we're going to do it. So let's do it. And I kept thinking about it as I was calling those guys. I keep going back to that. It's like I was choking up, and I'm like, dude, like, why am I choking up?
No,
it's because there's that much care.
Yes.
You know, it's like, like, again, my baby, like, I felt like I was not only disappointing everyone, but I was just like, this is the last thing I want to do. Now, it's not the worst case scenario considering the circumstances, but it's the same thing. It's like when again, like, if Nook's my friend and all that stuff, and he knows I'm in, like, this relationship that is, that everyone around you is, like, saying, like, I don't know how they do it. Like, they're going to break up. They're going to break up. They're going to break up. And, you know, like, there's all this stuff. And then it's like, I call Nook, and he's like, he never calls, he texts, so it's, I bet you, so-and-so left, or whatever it might be.
Well, yeah.
And that's why, like, I felt like I was explaining. Like, I've already been hurt, but now I got to tell, like, 11 different people if I want to. It's like, hey, by the way, like, wedding's off.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's how I felt.
But that's what I...
That's what it felt like.
But you put more work into most weddings you did into this event.
We have a text relationship. Like, we text all the time.
That's right. That's right.
So, like, you know, like, not like with, you know, like how I text with other customers. Like, we'll text, like, on the weekends, shit like that. And then also I see Steve Crane pop up my caller ID. I'm like, oh, fuck.
Everyone knew it was bad.
I just knew it was bad.
Dude, I had that experience. I'm not going to get too into this, but it's like, this is... When things change, I gotta be honest. Like, and this is a little bit, again, not as planned of a topic, but I gotta be. I had a similar feeling, and this is way more impactful. Way more impactful.
Yeah.
But when I woke up one morning, and my mom was calling at like 6:15 a.m.
Yeah.
That's not a thing.
Yeah.
Never a thing.
Yeah.
And even now, like, I still, when I see her call, it's like I have to pick up in case something's wrong, you know, because she does call, but we'll go a week or two, and she's in town, you know?
Yeah.
But when she called, it was, you know, there was a gut reaction there for me that I was like, all right, so dad's probably in the hospital or whatever. Man. It was day, I mean, and again, I'm not trying to, like, take it that route, but it's like it was the day that my dad passed away. And you have that. You have that feeling where it's like, all right, so now what?
I've had that before.
Yeah.
And it's like, now what? So
that's
where I kind of wanted to get in this conversation, is that, like, you can't necessarily change those things. You can just, like you said, and I appreciate you saying that, Nate, is that this is, it's how you handle it going forward. And even with this event, I mean, it's something that with going over and talk to the guys over at Fido.
Yeah.
When I first said it, you know, because they were trying to, like, call an audible. I'm like, hey, all right, we'll set these tables up here and do this and all that stuff. And I'm like, I don't want to do a shitty event. You know what I mean? So, like, I went over there and I told them. And at first, when I said, hey, we decided that we're going to cancel our event. And I could see it in Scott, who's a friend of mine and also the owner of Fido. I could see it in his eyes that he was angry already, because he's already, like, talking to, you know, he's doing his own, because he canceled his party.
Yeah.
And so he's like, I got to be honest, I'm extremely disappointed. He's like, when I talked to you, you know, a couple of days ago about the Dublin thing being canceled, he's like, this is where I feel like this is an opportunity for us to be leaders in our industry. And as I finished what I was saying, and I was telling him, I was like, this is what I want to do, you know, because he's like, we got all this food. He's like, starting to go into it. And I'm like, you're not selling me on it. It's the fact that I still want to invite people up, but they're not, they paid for. Our event is not the same as, like, paying a cover to come into a St. Patrick's Day party.
It's an experience.
It's an experience, which theirs is too, but it's an experience where it's like, this is what you're getting for your money.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it's not $10. It's $130 or $225. So it's like, I can't just abbreviate the event and say, all right, we're still doing it. It's up to you if you want to come, but no refunds. Like, that's how you don't handle it.
Correct.
So it's like, these are your options. That's what the email said. These are your options. And it did take me a little bit of time to collect myself.
Yeah.
And I think that's a point that I want to talk about when this shit happens.
Yeah.
you gotta collect yourself.
Yeah.
When I'm talking to Nook and I'm talking to all the other people in the industry, and I'm talking to Scott, I'm talking to the customers that are listening. I was choking up.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was like rage versus sad. I want to throw something, and I also want to like cry. Yeah. Like I couldn't get it out. And like now talking about it on the podcast, it's something where it's like there's a little bit of rage fueling me, clearly. I mean, if you guys were listening,
I could hear it in your voice on the phone. But that also got my mind turning, like, listen, how can we turn it around and make the best of what we have to deal with?
There's no changing it.
There's not at all.
When things change outside of your control, that's my whole thought process is like, it sucks. You can pout. You can go to your room and I'm never coming out, mom and dad. I hate you. You know what I mean? Like, fuck you. Never coming out. Yeah. And it's like, well, I'm hungry, so I'm coming out. You know, like, you have that part of it. It's like life also continues to progress. And I don't know. What do you guys think? Have you had experiences?
Yeah,
I mean, you're dealing with obviously the business side now. But I mean, as far as like anything, I mean, like
Funny. There's what are the seven stages of grief? Like denial, self bitterness,
rage, and then
it's collective bargaining, you know, and whatever, and it ends with self acceptance.
Don't hurt anyone.
Yeah, I did.
Don't you start.
So when.
Took a shot right before this.
Early on in my career, my wife and I both started our grown-up jobs, our big people jobs.
When was this?
Not too long. Okay. It came down to it.
Your FedEx job?
Yeah. Okay. I got this big deal job, big dot deal job. And my wife had loan forgiveness in Michigan. And so the call was made that I would move to Pittsburgh to become a thing at FedEx.
Yeah.
And my wife would stay on in Grand Rapids, and we would commute back and forth. And we made this commitment. We decided as a couple we would do this. And so I kept like two homes. I lived in Grand Rapids, and I commuted. And so I got my physical in Grand Rapids. I kept my doctor's in Grand Rapids. And I'll never forget this because – I had just had my physical, and in Michigan in the winter, all you do is talk about golf because you just hope for the summer. And so my doctor and I had finished our physical. We're talking about, you know, golf, and he's like, hey, you got this thing. Let me take something. I'm going to send it off to the lab. And I was like, oh, okay. I thought nothing of it. And then 2 weeks later, there's a whole other bottle. Keep pouring.
That's a heavy pour. I'll take some.
Yeah, we had a comment from David Cox here that asked us how many bottles are empty now. Well, both.
Now three. Bottle three's down.
Well, now it's three. Two St. Liberty. Yeah. But we still have another bottle of Knickerbocker here.
Yeah.
Open. And we're gonna Nate's gonna tell us the history behind the barrel aged.
Yeah, real quick though, let me finish the thought because I'm driving back from Pittsburgh 2 weeks after my physical, and my doctor calls me on a Friday, and I never even thought about the doctor calling me, not his office, but it's like the doctor, and he's like, "Hey, Nate, you driving right now?" I'm like, "Yeah."
All right, so first of all, anytime a doctor calls,
not the office, not like, "Hey, the doctor calls."
And then he asks you,
"Are you driving?" And I'm like, "Yeah,
not actually, are you sitting down, which is better. Yeah, are you driving is better than are you sitting down?"
You know, the speakerphone.
Are you sitting down is that classic thing.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. He said, these words. Cheers to this. Yeah. I need you to pull over. I have a counselor on the phone. And at that point.
This is off of a physical?
All from physical. 2 weeks later. And I had an out-of-body experience. I literally saw my physical body.
I thought you were talking like a bird's eye view.
Through the sunroof of my car.
Oh, that was,
I physically saw myself like out of my body.
Wow.
And that's when he told me that I had stage 3 cancer. Are you kidding me? I had to go through. And at that point, I tell people two things. You need to have an advocate, someone with you who has their wits, because The second thing is you're going to say yes to whatever is told to you, and you're not going to retain it. I don't remember the conversation. Thank God my wife, who's fierce as hell, she's in the room. She's taking notes. She's asking questions. So I wasn't agreeing to the very next thing. But, yeah, we went through all of it.
When was this?
This was a long time ago. I am now in remission.
Congratulations.
I tell people this all the time, though, and this is where we talk about the things change.
I've heard about this.
It's a weird part about this podcast.
Isn't
this
fun?
My dad did not tell me about this.
So I tell everyone this, and this is huge to me. It takes getting cancer to get healthy. And here's what I mean when I say this.
Okay.
At this point in my life.
Please.
Yeah. At this point in my life, I had made a lot of compromises to get to where I was at in my career.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't think about the things I was putting in my body. I didn't think about how I was eating. I treated life like I was invincible, only to find out I was like 3 months away from dying.
How old are you?
I was 25.
So, yeah, that makes sense, right?
Yeah,
I mean, clearly.
Yeah, I was 25. And so what I did is there's two things when you're faced with death. I think that you become really closed off and like careful, and you don't take any risks. Or the second thing is called the "I don't give a fuck" mentality.
I'm going skydiving. Tim McGraw had a song.
Literally, the things that really you worried about, you don't worry about anymore. And
what'd you say?
I said Tim McGraw has a song about that. He said, "Yeah, big green tractor." Like, clearly not a country fan over here. Thanks for making.
I don't know it either. But
that's a country song, though, right?
It's a country song. Yeah. All right, go ahead.
But no.
Jason Aldean.
That is.
I know.
I digress. We'll go on to Jen.
But no, I did.
So we talk about change. I made a healthy change in my life. I ran the Pittsburgh Marathon. I dumped like 30 pounds. I got healthy. I'm in remission. And I did. I started to run. I started to take healthy steps. And I realized every day is a gift in that we take time for granted. We waste so much freaking time.
Especially at 25 where you were at that age.
Yeah. So, knock on wood, things are good. But that change ultimately led to me leaving the corporate structure and starting a company and creating jobs and doing what we're doing now with the original Tin Cup Company and helping out with St. Liberty. But the big thing is helping out with New Holland here. And that's my awesome pivot and transition.
Wait, real quick.
Yeah.
My dad, because he mentioned to me, because he met Nate when he worked with FedEx.
Right. That's how the whole connection happened.
That's how the whole
thing
happened. And my dad always said that Nate was the youngest guy that he's ever met with so much drive and passion.
Now you know why.
He's never seen that before. And then... turns out, like, my dad retired, and then Nate gives my dad a call, I guess, with the respect factor that, like, my dad,
I needed help on the project
before.
Yeah.
And then he brought me in. But it was just crazy. Like, my dad's like, dude, that guy was young guy just with passion. He's never seen it before.
Was that before?
No, this was after the cancer.
Okay.
But you
had drive, obviously, before that.
I wouldn't have been But
you're absolutely right. And I actually, it's funny. I love how you were about to, like, not use that story, but you're like, all right, I'm going to get it off my chest because you clearly don't talk about it all the time.
No, I don't.
Yeah, I appreciate you sharing that because it's super powerful. And one of the things I love about doing this podcast is that this is something where we didn't really have a topic tonight, like I said, because the structure of the entire week was going to be different.
Yeah.
And now things changed.
Yeah.
And we're sitting here at this table, and you're sharing with whoever's listening to this at this point, and whoever listened to the audio and come back and listen to it. And I'm definitely going to share, some of the stuff that you allowed us to listen to, which I appreciate.
Yeah, thank you.
But you were also going to segue that into the gin we're drinking, which is where I'm going to stop you.
I guess we're getting cranky about what cigar we're smoking right now.
Oh, yeah. See, this is
what we're drinking.
Forget about this guy talking about the fact that he almost died.
All right, guys, come on now.
No. Listen, this is what I really
You guys just go out and buy some more stuff. Toilet paper and
they're
just be fine with your life.
They're not. I'm just giving everyone a hard time. So we were drinking. Hey, just real quick.
So this all led to the change, to the pivot.
So what we were doing before, if you're tuning in late, if you guys are tuning in late, the St. Liberty whiskey, which we listen to part one, or go back if you're watching the video. Watch the first hour.
Great
or so.
History on it.
Super good history.
Super good history on it.
Now we're going to be drinking the
Knickerbocker Barrel Aged Gin from New Holland.
Barrel-aged gin that does not, if you guys can see that on the camera, that does not look like your typical gin.
It does
we're
not.
We're smoking currently the CLE Azabache, which is killer smoke, San Andreas wrapper. That's going to be 15. That's 15% off at the Tinder Box. Whether you come in, again, we talked about the Smoking 10 event. You can come in and actually, if you have a ticket, you can actually use that ticket still. Again, not substituting. We're not calling an audible. This is something separate, but we are, when things change, we are moving forward. We are doing the best we can with it, and we have a couple options for anyone that did that. But this is a great cigar. We also smoked the first 20 years from Eiroa, which was a fantastic. Again, part one, if you guys are listening to the audio, go back to part one, 109.1, and listen to that part of it.
Just, I want to say, for a lot of the people that just joined, a lot of the people, I've been looking down at the who's joined, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. A lot of the regular listeners have missed part one. And just to go back and hear what Nate said about, mm-hmm. about St. Liberty, a the lot passion, of the guys, really. Like, the passion that Nate has behind that, and it's not a Kentucky company. And we talked about that earlier on. But just... the whole lineage and the whole series that are coming out right now, it's just amazing. So I recommend that you guys all go back and listen to that. You guys will be very surprised.
Thank you very much. So that was a great cigar, too.
It was. It always is.
This is awesome. This is spicy. This is
got spice.
Tell me the difference between Nook as a guy that does these at bachelor parties and baby births.
I know.
Tell me why.
More importantly, so we did Birdie first.
Yes.
So now we're bringing back New Holland.
This is a nice selection, by the way. Nook suggested this.
This is my selection. Like,
I love this.
I love how we have a cigar guy and a spirit guy sitting next to me, and they're both trying to, focus on the other one. You know what I'm saying? Like, the spirit guy's like, tell me about this cigar. Like, no, but, what we're talking about is this, and this is part two. Yeah. And mind you, there's Nate with the New Holland beer barrel.
Oh, yeah.
This is what happens. And again, I don't want to derail and have one of those, but I will say this, is that this is part two of a less planned podcast, which I actually, this is raw.
It's free play.
It's raw. It's free. Yeah. But let's do a quick recap before you guys talk about your cigar and your spirit. We had a major event closed down. We talked about that briefly, and we'll probably talk about it again because I'm absolutely going through those steps grief. I think I'm on the rage part.
rage
steps. And then we had Nate actually share his story about now he's in remission.
Wait, did we talk about that? I have the Steve sweater on today.
We haven't talked about that, but that's my point.
Nice Steve sweater.
We talked about all this stuff, and now it's tell me about your product. Tell me about your product. We're all awesome. You're cool. No, you're cool. You're both pretty girls.
Thank you.
Let's go.
Thank you. All right. So gin first.
So we went ahead. We did the St. Liberty. And then I went ahead and I saw that, over the past couple weeks, they did a little bit of freestyle, and we had some Irish whiskeys. Mm-hmm. So I've done New Holland in the past. We have a relationship there, and I'm like, listen, we've got some, since we're doing Birdie, and Nate's coming on, he does the distribution. I'm like, all right, well, we'll go ahead and look at the Knickerbocker gin. Knickerbocker gin is just an amazing, a regular, is just an amazing, it's
so
one of awards overseas,
gin.
Yes,
blah, 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 and this is the one that is actually barrel-aged.
Yes.
So I'm like, all right, barrel-aged with the bourbon.
Dude, this is like a cocktail.
Which is the
color. I gotta be honest, this is like a cocktail.
It's amazing. So gin, here's, we'll go back to history on this.
All right.
Gin is, when you look at alcohol, it's highly regulated. We talked about the rules in the first half about what it takes to be
whiskeys
called a bourbon.
And bourbons, yeah.
What it calls to be called a bourbon. Gin, in the federal regulation says it must start out as a neutral grain spirit with juniper and coriander present. End sentence. That's it. You are allowed to do unbelievable, amazing things with gin. Like when a highly regulated industry, this one thing, we have a wide open range. And so literally there's two ingredients, neutral grain spirit. Outside of that, you can do anything. And so I really think we're on the verge of a genaissance in this country. You look at like Spain, you look at all these other countries that are really doing some cool shit with gin right now.
I think gin and rum are the two next ones.
Oh my God, absolutely.
Vodka had their day. They're still doing well, right? Tequila's tequila. Yeah, I think there's a lot of good tequilas out there. It's not as hot. Bourbon, obviously, whiskey. Yeah. Crazy. Gin and rum.
Next two, yes.
Next two.
And so our gin here, and I say R as in I help New Holland with their go-to-market, is
awesome.
New Holland is one of the largest breweries in the state of Michigan, and that's saying something in the state that has Founders and Bell's. They're one of the largest breweries in the state. They have this unbelievable thing called Dragon's Milk. It's the number one stout in the country, barrel-aged stout in the country. And you can get it anywhere in Ohio, in the country.
10-ish percent.
Yeah, oh, it is awesome. And it's only like $20 for a 4-pack. It's so good. And so the way we get to Dragon's Milk is this beautiful story. And it starts out with the bourbon, and they pull the bourbon out of the barrel, and that's the barrel where they barrel-age the stout. Once the stout's bottled, they put the bourbon back in the barrel to finish it for 90 days, hence why they call it beer barrel bourbon.
That's the bottle that Nate's
that's
got
the
over
bottle
there,
that Nate's got. That
that's
barrel,
right.
Yeah.
We did feature that on next
that
episode,
barrel
yeah.
doesn't end there.
And Dustin was on New Holland's Instagram.
Oh, was he?
With the bottle.
That's right.
With the bottle. It's like 100,000 followers, man.
We are
celebrity.
Actually, that photo got
a
lot of hits off that one.
A podcast up at the
anytime.
The brewery distillery.
Let us know. Yeah. We're down. We're down.
He's been
anytime.
Working on it.
Yeah. Well, we'll do it up in the Zeppelin Lounge. We'll do it in front of the still. We'll do it in front of the still that this stuff is made in.
Yeah.
Because after that barrel is done, it's not done. It becomes the home to our gin. We make several different gins. Our original Knickerbocker gin, which is our base gin. We do a Knickerbocker blueberry, a Knickerbocker grapefruit, and then our barrel-aged gin. And those are all available in Ohio. And
gin, it's not normally, like for me, gin is a mixture at the very least, gin and tonic, right?
I mean, sure.
From,
yeah, sure.
For me, right? And
yes.
That's all I knew.
And it's most gins.
Well,
that's all I knew from the beginning.
And Liz, my girlfriend's dad, Liz's dad, is a big gin and tonic guy, right? Yeah. So, you know, when I was over there for a holiday celebration, he's the type of, he'd get along well with everyone here, right? So, like, all of us here.
Yeah.
The problem is that at the end of the night, you know, Liz's parents basically drove us home. And her stepmom just wanted to drive my car.
Okay.
I think that might have been like the thing about like this
the
is
caddy.
Why we're gonna get, yeah, the caddy.
That's a, yeah, this is
yeah,
this
but
guy.
It was just funny because it's like, you know, he's like pulling, he's like, "Oh, you went to Cuba, right?" And we were talking about Cuba and all that stuff.
Yeah,
he's like,
yeah,
I had this Cuban rum. Have you had this one? I was like, "No, I haven't had that one." And I had about like this much left in the glass.
Yeah.
And he's like, "Do you like gin?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I like gin." He's like, "Have you ever had Plymouth? You heard Plymouth?
Oh, I love Plymouth. Oh,
so does he. So he pulls out a bottle and he's like, "All right, this is your bottle, but can I make you a gin and tonic?" I'm like, "Well, I haven't finished this." He's like, "I'm going to make you a gin and tonic."
I like this guy already. I like this guy. He's my kind of people.
You'd absolutely love him. But this is a sipper.
This is a sipper.
This is actually something that I bet you even would be better with a couple of ice cubes. Just sip on it.
I would recommend it.
Crazy.
Yes. The color is clearly that it's came from a barrel.
But
it's not straight off from the still.
You know what?
Which is typical of gins.
How long did it spend in a barrel?
This has been at least 90 days in a barrel.
Wow, okay. That's the color.
That's the color.
Now, is this colored at all? Like,
there's no artificial coloring,
the only
no caramel.
I say that. So when we had Pat and Martin on last week, and they actually talked about it, we looked at the BUA. Nate's going to pull it out again for you guys to look at it. But you see the color of that?
Yeah,
very light, but they said that this is about as authentic as it gets.
Correct.
Where there are a lot of distilleries, and I didn't know that they add coloring.
They add coloring,
and they didn't. And it's like, well, that's going to stand out not only because of the blue label. this is going to stand out because if this is in the gin aisle, this looks like they use like, I'm not trying to be offensive, this looks like they use like well water to make make their gin. And you're like, you're like, gin, what's that? That's in the wrong aisle.
And it's delicious.
It's delicious. Awesome.
Yeah. The bottle's shaped like a still. I mean, it's cool as hell. So, cool. Yeah. And that's so with regards to the, I mentioned two ingredients, you know, the juniper piece and the coriander. So that piney thing that people either love or hate. They either love or hate. Yeah. It's there.
It tastes like a gin and tonic by itself.
It's amazing. But then you add all these other botanicals. So we have 12 botanicals in this gin. Our blueberry and our grapefruit have 13, and the 13th botanical is either the blueberry or the grapefruit.
Wow.
And so some guys get way crazy, up to like, you know, 20 botanicals. Most of your standard people are going to be right at that 5 or 6 botanicals. Yeah. Like Hendrix is, I think it's 7 or 8. And we're a little bit above the board there. But the way this whole thing works, you start out with like neutral spirits.
Yeah.
And I call it like the pillowcase tea bag. It's literally a tea bag the size of a pillowcase.
Things, crowds,
and it's full of our awesome. What'd you say? I didn't. That's the wrong tea bag. Okay.
No, I said I think that the pillowcase tea bag means different things in different crowds.
Yeah. I was just wrong tea bag. Yeah. No. Shit.
It's called hazing.
Okay. Yeah.
2020.
Yeah. That was a long time ago.
Anymore.
Yeah. No. There's
yeah.
Yeah,
me fraternities too. Have been disbanded because of this process. But go
so
on.
So you put it in the neutral grain spirit, and after like you could put a body in there, and it's gone after a couple of days.
Wait, you put a body in there?
Not quite. Jesus. But you, it's neutral spirit. Like it's gonna just dissolve all of this stuff, and it's gonna become sort of gunky looking. It looks pretty nasty.
Yeah.
And so what you do is you put it on a copper pot still.
Yeah.
And when you heat that up, the alcohol evaporates and recondenses on the other side, as well as these botanicals. The essential oils are basically what goes over. And each essential oil has an evaporation point below the boiling point of water, which is 212 degrees. And so before we get to full boil, you want to get all of those essential oils over, then cut it before any of the gunk goes over. So when it comes out perfectly clear. And then in your pot, you have the pot of gunk, basically. So you clear that pot out in that perfectly clear liquid.
Is gunk an industry term? Or
gunk is a very scientific term. It's very scientific. Yeah, it's also a medical term too, but I don't want to go there. So, no, I'm just kidding.
All right, go on.
And then that clear spirit though, that can go straight to a bottle. That's a neutral grain spirit. That's gin, or we take it, like I said, another 90 days at least, and put it into a barrel, and that barrel is a heavy charred barrel.
Yeah.
So there's the char has a lot to do with the caramel color too. And so I know the guys on last week were talking about that, but whether it's a medium char or a heavy char, Nate, are comments coming in right now? I'm assuming there's just some great,
we got a little bit.
Great juicy comments. I can't see it. My phone died after hour
someone
one.
Someone wanted to ask Nook if that sweater comes in adult sizes.
Oh.
Listen, I actually did get a comment on here that said they like my sweater.
It's a very nice sweater.
It's a very handsome sweater.
Yeah.
In the Gap
Kids
section.
I'm surprised I don't
Gap
have
Kids
that.
Section.
Does it keep your legs warm too?
Oh, Jesus.
All right. No, come on.
All right,
I know it's hour two, but
I'm just trying to fill the role of sweater host.
I had to sport the new hoodie.
Yeah, the hoodie's great. You can talk about the hoodie. I like the hoodie.
Steve and I had a meeting this morning. He was gonna rock the new BS.
The BS hoodie, yeah.
Which will be available for purchase. And I told him that I would rock the Steve gear.
No,
I did bring the sweater.
That's nice.
It's a button up like Steve usually wears. So
it's a cardigan. It's a handsome cardigan.
Yeah, cardigan. Very handsome.
Good cardigan.
I do like the t-shirt underneath, by the way. I showed off my t-shirt.
Why Steve always wears a t-shirt underneath.
Oh, that is
usually
a nice
if
t-shirt.
I wear this. If anybody wants to know, if
you
I usually
do
wears
a button
it,
up.
I do a button up with a tie, but I'm going full Steve.
Full Steve.
And we're doing the Eroa t-shirt.
You look.
I want one of those.
Handsome.
I didn't see that. I didn't read
there
that before.
Go.
I want that shirt.
So,
that's an awesome shirt.
Real quick side story, and this is the type of episode.
Now
so I'm assuming that if
awesome.
You're listening to the audio, you might be tuning out at this point. But if you actually, if you're listening. We had the slideshow
going.
I'm
getting trolled in my own personal DMs right now.
We had the slideshow going from the previous. I'm not doing it. But like we, so it's funny. We talk about sweaters, right?
Yeah.
Side note, a guy who comes in on a regular basis, right? And he buys Isla del Sol's, right? And
yeah.
This
oh.
is his thing, right? So great everyday cigar, and yes, he loves them and all this stuff. And he looks up at the slideshow, and he looks at me. He's like, "Hey, that that sweater you had on in that picture." And I look up at the TV, and it's already gone. He's like, "I don't know. It's like a really light gray." And I was like, "Yeah, everyone loves that sweater." He's like, "Dude, what is that? Where do I get that?" And I was like, "You can dress up with this, right?" And he's like, "Dude, yeah, I know. It's amazing." And I'm like, "Yeah, it's called a cardigan." He's like, "Cardigan." Okay. I know as soon as he left there before he started his car, he's on Google. He's like, cardigan sweater, light gray. I mean, it's amazing. I'm in the wrong business. But with things change, getting back to the podcast.
So
I gotta ask. So like,
so we got the so the regular.
Never mind.
He's got regular Knickerbocker too. Like, yeah,
like
yeah.
They've.
So that's what I wanted to ask. Awards, yeah. No, right? Hang on. I wanted to ask. When you guys are doing this, right, and a lot of this conversation is about when things change, but
yeah.
I look at this and New Holland, yeah, the biggest thing with New Holland is obviously the beer, right?
Sure.
All right, so
sure.
that's the moneymaker. That's the bread and butter.
That is. It pays the bills.
So you guys are going out there and doing things like this where it is off the beaten path.
Correct.
You're changing things.
Correct.
You're being the leader as far as that goes, where it's like you're not waiting for the industry to change. You're not waiting for things around you to change. And bear with me. I think this is something that is relevant to the conversation, is that you guys are doing things. So you have some more of the traditional ones.
Yeah.
You got to make that. You got to give yourself credibility.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to like something like this, is that you look at it and you look at, like, you know, Nate brought up that beer barrel.
Yeah.
Bourbon.
Yeah.
It's like, it's not for everyone. No. You're not going to compete with Buffalo Trace products.
No, and then we don't want to. We know our place in the market.
Yes. You don't, but you have your own bourbon. You have your own gin. So it's like,
Nate,
again,
we brought up
the Plymouth that my girlfriend's dad loves. But look at the color of those things.
So here's the cool
they're
thing.
Actually very similar.
Very, but the
cool bourbon's darker.
Yeah, clearly it spent more time in a barrel. But the cool thing about the name you just brought up, Knickerbocker. Knickerbocker,
I think of the New York Knicks, and I hate it.
Is a Dutch explorer. So in Holland, New Holland, we're Hollanders,
John Starks was a.
What? Oh man,
go on.
So Knickerbocker, it's a name for a Dutch explorer, a Dutch vagabond. Literally in the 1700s, this guy would go town to town and he would explore new areas. Probably was a minstrel of types. And Genever is a parent spirit to the Netherlands.
Okay.
So gin actually came from the Netherlands. The English did what they do, and they came through in their trades and whatever. And they're like, "Oh yeah, we can do this better." And they came up with London Dry Gin.
Yeah.
Genever stayed with the Netherlands as a spirit, and you go into Belgium, Genever culture is huge there. And a Knickerbocker would have been this person from this era that would have went town to town and would have sold things, like a medicine man type person. And so as a brewery, we started out as a brewery, and we started to explore this other area, this area of distilling. Brett Vanderkamp, the founder and creator of New Holland, wanted to start to distill spirits and found out you can't do it in Michigan. And so we helped work to change the laws in Michigan. The first spirit that was a high-proof spirit that was produced in Michigan legally was our Zeppelin Bend. And that was
Which
in 2008. He started in 2005, but 2008.
Which is what? What's the Zeppelin?
Zeppelin is a single malt whiskey that we do. It's an American single malt.
All right.
That's why we came up with the name Knickerbocker, was the idea of exploration, of change, of going out there and finding something new, which is what these Knickerbockers did in the 1700s. So it's cool that you brought up the name. So
no, I like the name. I think it's something that, you know, and I'm gonna kind of steer the boat back this way.
Yeah.
And There are times when we talk about like the fact that going back in the conversation again, I want to give a quick summary because I think it's hilarious. Is that I talked about our event being closed down and things are happening out of your control, and then you, Nate, brought in your bout with cancer.
Yeah.
And then you guys started talking about your products, and now we're doing the products again. And I look at it as like, this is something that if you have an opportunity when things are going well, right?
Yeah.
You don't always have to go with the trends.
Correct.
You know, and I think that's a big part of it, is that even though there's two sides of that when things change, right?
Yeah.
And maybe this is a reach to some people, but to me, I my mind's thinking this way. A lot of caffeine to battle my stress and the fact that I just wanted to do the
– yeah.
Whatever I think I missed, what
yeah, what were the steps that we missed?
What was the step I missed?
Yeah, what are the steps?
Was it
depression
and anguish?
No,
I went through
denial.
That
no, the first step is denial. I think you skipped right past
no,
that.
No, I did that. I was ready to be like, no, this isn't happening. Like
the rage.
No, then
rage.
Stage two is anger.
Rage.
Which Steve's gonna be at anger for a while.
Bargaining. No, bargaining
until next March.
Number three is bargaining, which is I think where Steve is also going into with us doing something else.
No, kinda. All right, no. So let me comment on that. Yeah. That's what I want to...
And then you have depression and acceptance.
Did all that, too.
That was in the beginning.
I think you're lumping in the last four together.
He did the back stuff, like, in the beginning, and then just kind of went to rage.
What I like about...
That's how you do it, though, man. You just pile up the dumb shit in the beginning, and you just fucking just...
Summary of my life.
And then you can just do the rage.
I think that he's actually... Steve's at the acceptance side. He's at the acceptance side. We're going to make an amazing...
No one hears from me in the morning?
No, you're at the acceptance
phase. What's the movie
phase?
Where Brad Pitt's out there and you're like, what are you, suicidal? I think it's Ocean's 11. Are you suicidal? Only in the morning. That's
a great
me
reference.
On a daily basis.
Yes.
I'm not trying to scare anyone, but it's like my lowest point sometimes is when I wake up, I'm like, fuck this. And then it's like I look over at Liz. Yeah. I'm like, well, that's a good start. And then I look, get up and I'm like, my knee hurts. Well, it'll get better because I know if I walk it off.
Yeah.
And that's what happened today with this event. So
yeah, there you go.
I did all that stuff. Maybe not in that order. The denial thing was like, how do we get this done? 12 minutes, maybe.
Wow.
That's being gracious.
Wow.
Yeah, it was a pretty small window right there.
Let's just say this is that I'm happy you guys are here because I needed a drink.
I'm grateful to be here. I'm honored. I drove from Grand Rapids to be here. I'm honored that you'd let us be on, that you'd let me share my story, that you let me share a personal story as well as our products. We don't take that for granted. It's not lost on us. It's not lost on the companies that I represent here.
Well, what I like about the fact that you shared that, and that's what I like about this podcast a lot, is that when it comes down to it, it's the people behind it. And that, let's bring back full circle. It's like, when things change, we're talking about these things that are out of your control. There's always people involved. And that's the big part about this. And so there's always everyone's personal agenda. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I've tried to really, really focus on in recent years, in personal growth, and I don't know how you guys feel about this, is that when everyone, I mentioned it being selfish.
Yeah.
But we're in a time right now, especially with all the political talk and all the politics going on. It's like everyone's about their personal agenda. What I mean? I had a conversation with my girlfriend last night in this garage, and it was like at the end of it, we partially agreed to disagree, but at the same time, we had to hash things out.
Yeah.
And one of the things we talked about was that it's like, things aren't always good, and there's things that you can't control. But sometimes it's the lesser of two evils. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it is what's the better of two positives also.
Yeah.
But you can't always, every little aspect of it, you can't carry it. You can't carry your agenda. You can't do that. So like when it comes down to this, I have my own views on this whole coronavirus thing. And I'm getting more to the point now that it's impacted what we're trying to do this weekend. Like obviously the personal agenda, I wanted to do this for everyone.
Absolutely.
It's not about me. It's not about us doing this and not about making money. Like we wouldn't go through all these steps, obviously, if it wasn't. We're in business. We want to make money, and it's like we don't necessarily make as much money on this type of event. And it's like with you guys doing this, you take a gamble doing something different. So it's like two sides of that coin where it's like you either react or you're trying to do things and get forward. But if you would have done this whole thing with a Knickerbocker barrel-aged gin, and one you have, it doesn't get received well.
Yeah.
Or if all of a sudden they change the laws and they say, well, you can't do that because of whatever process you're doing.
Yeah.
You're fucked.
Yeah.
But you keep doing it. You respond. You're like, all right, I can't do it this way. So what do we do? Like, this is it. This is my whole thing. Is that when we're doing these things and things change outside of your control, it's I was one of those people that, you know, it's like when you go through like a breakup.
Yeah.
All you want to do is you want to fight it. You want to say it's not real. You want to go through the steps that Nate just talked about. And you know, what was the first one?
Denial.
Yeah. Always.
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 Always denial.
Yeah. Mike DeWine, you know, like the governor of the state of Ohio's, like he's going to make his address here in about 20 minutes. I'm like, okay, probably can't be that bad. You know, like, whatever.
Yeah.
I already knew what he was going to say. I knew we were going to have to cancel this.
Yeah.
We knew things were going to change.
Yeah.
When someone says, like, hey, we need to talk. When a girlfriend says, boyfriend. Yeah, the whole garage is like, oh.
It's done.
That's what
done.
I'm saying. It's like when an employer says, like, hey, can we set up a meeting for Monday at 9 a.m.? You're like,
no.
Yes, I guess. You know something's coming. So, yeah, denial, like one of those things. Like you can do that. You can absolutely just be like, if I don't show up. I look at it as like you're a kid where it's like if I close my eyes – none of this is real.
Yeah.
And that is
kind of like in Blindside. Great movie.
So it is a good movie, but I appreciate what you guys are doing of being progressive.
Thank you.
Because what I like about that is, and that's what I'll bring into this, and you guys can respond to this idea is that when you are doing these things, when you're doing that, and with business, it's like you're going to have those obstacles with your personal relationships and your personal life, with your health. And Nate, I really appreciate you.
Yeah.
Everyone knows someone that has battled with cancer or something else.
Yeah.
And I don't want to focus on this, but I also don't want to breeze over it, is that when it happens to you or someone that's close to you, something changes, someone gets fired, someone gets a breakup or you know, like just life in a as quick as a light switch changes.
Yes.
You want to help that person, but if it's you in that situation, you go through those steps that Nate was talking about. And I think that it's something that if you prepare yourself, if you're living your life and you can respond to that way. And I think what I'm taking away from this, and that's what I really appreciate about this conversation, because I had no idea, And obviously Nook didn't have any idea about that.
No idea.
And he's blown away at this as well. But
and I've known Nate for a while.
Well, and when you it makes sense though now.
Yeah.
You know how this person is. Yeah. You know how they respond to things.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's those big, the trials that you go through, right? Yeah. The tribulations that you go through is that you learn who you are and you
Absolutely.
Learn you, like and honestly you grow, you change.
Yes.
And you don't know how it's going to happen. You don't know how it's going to come to you. You don't know how you're going to react. But I all I can say is I appreciate you sharing that because I'm blown away. I mean, it's fun to talk about all of this stuff because when things go well, and that's where we're at with a lot of these things, is that, like right now, with everything going on right now, and that's, I think, why it's a relevant topic, is that, you know, people go into work, you know, like Dustin's in the audience right now, and he's always, you know, responding to the Facebook quotes and or the feed and everything like that, and he's throwing out the messages. He's in a grocery store.
And he's got to worry about bringing toilet paper home.
Just toilet paper. Family. I mean, it's like there's another aspect of it.
Yeah.
All these little things that turn into big things, they change everything.
They do. They really do.
He needs to see the people buying the toilet paper, and he has to take them home to his family. Dustin's fucked now.
I could have told you that before this all hit.
No, I appreciate you guys being here.
Yeah.
When things change, I will say this. In fact, you know, let's do this. Let's bring it back to the old school here. Nate, give me some of your closing remarks based on this conversation.
Yeah, based on all that we've talked about here, I think that it's important, and we touched on this in the very beginning, the fact that you took ownership and you called people, you didn't just text.
Right.
You called them. You cared enough to talk to people.
Right.
When we care enough to face it truthfully, when we take steps to do things with integrity, which is what you guys are doing on Sunday with this event, in the fact that it's not an event, that you're doing things with integrity and saying, we're going to meet up and we're going to make it right for people that have already bought tickets.
Right.
When you do things with your products and your company that are with integrity, that are with intent, that are in response to circumstances that you can't control, those things are what separates the men from the boys. And so my takeaway is absolutely that we need to, when we're faced with adversity, how we respond makes the difference. When we're faced with a market that's doing one thing and we decide as a company to pivot and do something else, that's what, you know, hopefully people respond. Hopefully people buy it. Maybe it falls on its face. Then again, that's changed. You got to figure out how to get back to where it needs to be. We went through so many prototypes with our cups. We went through so many bottles with Birdie. We went through, so many product iterations to come up with a gin that's so fascinating to drink and so delicious. Take it back to the cigars. Yeah,
the garage loves it.
You know, talk about Christian and his story and his family and how they've changed and adapted. It's amazing.
13 years.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. So that's my take is how we respond is what matters. I'm so grateful you'd have me on today.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
That you would stand up for what you're doing and how you've taken it.
The one thing, how many awards has Knickerbocker won?
Hey, Mike.
How many awards has Knickerbocker won? Dude, I'm so used to the old stuff.
I know. This is better audio for
this is way better audio. Very fast, fancy technology.
To the fans out there. Like, I was telling Steve about what Knickerbocker actually was.
Yeah.
And how they were. I explained the process, blah, blah, blah. I know all that. But the awards that they've won. Like,
a ton.
How it is.
Yeah. We've been recognized as our gin. Our traditional Knickerbocker is one, you know, number one craft gin in America.
That's available like nationwide.
Oh,
right?
It's available in Ohio, everywhere. Right. Yeah. Because, anywhere you can want to get it.
Yeah, because
if it's not there in your listening audience, ask for it. They can bring it in.
Yeah, Steve, you said that, you know, that's something that you would actually want to purchase for your
for Liz's dad.
Yeah.
Well, I got to get two bottles of gin now because we're going to do this one and then the traditional and see how it stacks up to Plymouth for him.
Yeah.
All right, Nook, your closing remarks on this.
I don't have much. Like, this is actually.
Appreciate your brevity.
Nah, fuck that. I'm going to be short and concise.
Perfect.
But I didn't lose my keys this week. So that's a good thing.
For those of you who don't know, last time Nook was on, if you watch,
but I'm going to put my Steve sweater back on right now because I'm actually getting kind of chilly.
It's getting chilly. It's Ohio.
Yeah, it's a little bit chilly. You know what? They actually
here, let me help you out.
The audience loves this because they liked my cardigan.
They do like your cardigan
for Steve. So. All right, I'm putting my Steve sweater back on right now.
Dumb and Dumber, like, pull over. It's a cardigan. Thanks for asking.
Anyways, but
that is so great. Oh, there goes the glass.
That's all right.
There goes.
Got a water glass break. Anyways,
you got close.
But we had.
I think that was it.
No, man. We had a long week thus far, and we're only like 3 days into it.
It's Wednesday.
You know, I came out here. This was going to be my long week. I looked at March on my calendar. I'm like, fuck, I'm in Columbus for a while. But you
it's
know
not
what?
That bad.
But I said, you know what? We're going to fucking bang it out at the end of the week because this is the best event that Ohio has to offer.
Appreciate that.
So, you know what, guys? Everybody listening, we're still going to rock it out. Come to Fado. Come to the patio. You can smoke outside the patio.
Yeah.
I don't care. But it's going to be, listen, it's going to be the guys from the Tinder Box, the reps that are out there. We're still going to make it as best as you can to smoke on a Sunday. Listen, what are you doing every other Sunday? You might be like
Sunday
going to the church.
Baby.
maybe smoking outside your house, the wife's yelling at you to like clean some dishes, clean the fucking whatever. But you know what? Come down to Fadeau.
You're right.
Grab your ticket. Listen, we're going to be there. The guys that are there, we're going to give you some good deals. But you know what? It's amazing deals. It's just going to be about camaraderie. We're going to be smoking cigars and drinking.
Yeah.
Plain and simple. Fuck the coronavirus.
Oh, well.
You know what? Yeah. I'm going to be political right now.
No.
You know what? We're going to be smoking and drinking on Sunday.
There you go. So
That's it, man. Listen, and we have the Azabache. We didn't get to talk about that earlier on, but it is a San Andreas wrapper with
talking
a
the mic, tell him.
With a Honduran binder. Also, we represent that cigar with a Corojo.
Oh my God!
Peruvian and Nicaraguan.
We didn't talk about it.
So, you know what? But
if you guys
15% off this week.
That's right. Thank you, Nick.
I don't know how to talk on mic, so that's fair. It's been weird and awkward. But
no, it's you know different what? Than last time.
I got the Steve sweater on, so it's okay.
All right. So I agree. You look super handsome. I've said that. Todd Boss says he's going to be there, so I think we're gonna have a good crowd on Sunday. Things change, and that's for me the biggest thing with all of this is that at the age that I'm at right now is I was talking to Liz last night, and
yeah,
you know, so her mom and stepdad are looking at houses right now.
Okay.
And there's a lot of dialogue between Liz and myself about a lot of this stuff, and you know, she's 25, I'm 39, and so we're at different stages of our life, but we're doing it together.
Yeah.
And we had a conversation about this very topic without even realizing it when I'm talking about this. I didn't know today was going to happen. I kind of, like a lot of people, I thought that things were going to change, but I looked at it as at one point in my life, like when I was at her age, at 25, I was engaged and I was in a house, and it was going to be like, by the time I'm this age, I'm going to be at this point.
Yeah.
And then everything changed. And I went through my ups and downs, and what I like about doing a podcast like this, and again, I keep going back to the fact that Nate, you shared your bout with cancer to a point, right? And we've had like Sean, who's in the garage. If you go back and listen to his episode, he had some similar experiences that, but we went into more detail.
Yeah.
And when you deal with things like that, you always think that it might happen, but it probably won't happen to you.
Correct.
That's the same way that I thought about this tent thing. I was like, if we can make it just like five more days, and then on Monday they come out and say this, you know, but when things come to the forefront, when you even if you expect it, when you least expect it, but it's tough, but when you most expect it, and you're like, all right, so we're holding, you know, it's like, again, going back to a job, right, where it's like you don't think that, you know, I know I'm not happy, I know they're not happy, this is not working out. But if I can make one more paycheck, if I can do this, but all you're doing is trying to prevent, you're minimizing losses. That's what I in my mind, that's what I love about what you're talking about with some of the gin you're doing and some of the things that New Holland's doing about some of these things is that, and with St. Liberty, you're doing different things, is that it's a different mentality.
Absolutely.
The mentality is that you're not going to minimize losses. You have to at some point.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to it, you want to move forward by staying ahead of the curve, by doing your own thing, by knowing your identity, and that's my biggest thing. So when things happen outside of your control, don't lose your identity, because that's what I've done in the past, and I think a lot of people do that, and I think that as a business we could have done that with the Smoking Tent event. And so what we're doing is like I said, I'm trying to be as clear cut as I can.
Yeah,
much like a breakup, much like losing a family member. It's all these things. It's like you don't want it to happen. You don't want it to be real. And you can either stick to that and just stay in that phase, like Nate brought up. It's like you can deal with the denial phase. but you have to realize that
yes.
all these things are natural, but when it comes down to it, you have to actually move forward.
That yes. was the best thing you said to me on the phone today, was this is not the smoking tent event. Like,
it's not.
We had too many missteps.
Yeah.
We had last year with all of us coming in too late, and then the one with the fire marshal coming in. But listen, this is not the smoking tent event.
It's not.
But it's getting everybody back to believe.
It's getting to the core for me. Is that's my thing. And that's what I was talking with Liz about is that, you know, she was asking questions that we haven't really talked about a lot from my past. And I think that's where I'll leave this, is that when things change and people ask you, like with you, Nate, and, you know, the fact that this is what I love about it, is that the Nook didn't know about that thing.
Yeah.
Which was a big thing.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to gloss over it, but it's like he didn't know about that. And he's like, he looks at you and it's like, you were driven before, you're more driven now.
Yeah.
And then when things change, it is about how you adapt and grow and you move forward, because now all of a sudden it's like when things aren't changing, you're staying on the forefront. You're moving forward. You're constantly driven. You're doing these things because you don't want that to happen again. And if it does happen again, you're gonna figure it out.
Yeah.
And that's where it is with business, personal relationships, with anything else in life. No matter what comes your way, at some point you have to realize the fact that it's like you can't change it. So no matter what you did last night, we do a bourbon podcast for the most part, but then we have conversations like this.
Yeah.
One of my other former roommates, you know, it's one of those things where I woke up and I was like, man, I was drunk last night and I can't believe I said those things. I can't believe I did all that stuff. He's like, cool, right? He's like, can you change it? No. All right, so what are we doing today? And it's something as simple as that. When you talk about drinking, it's like, yeah, no, you absolutely made a fool of yourself last night. You absolutely said the wrong things.
How many I won the last time I was here?
Well, right. All right, but my point is like, but the thing is like, do you want to dwell on that, or do you want to like focus on today? Do you want to focus on tomorrow? Do you want to like keep moving forward? And that's my whole thing. And I'm going to leave it at that, is that when things change like this, and with the smoking tent event, with everything you went through, and I appreciate you sharing, Nate, and Nook, obviously being a part of this and sharing everything you've shared. But I got to say, the biggest thing, my biggest takeaway is the fact that a guy like Nate can share that, but also gloss over that. It's like, I had cancer. And then we did this with our bourbon and our gin. You're like, wait, like, scratch it back for a second. Like, hang on.
Yeah.
That's amazing. That actually shows the volume of who you are as a person and the character that people can have.
Yeah.
And I hope that anyone listened tonight and listening in the vehicles and on their headphones and everything else in the audio side, is that I hope you guys actually really stuck on that like I did, because that was a powerful thing that we didn't dive into, and I can appreciate you moving forward. But guys, I wanna thank our sponsors, Tinderbox at Easton, for our weekly cigar, and again we have a CLE Azabache 15% off.
Oh, yeah.
Sunday smoking tent event is not happening. We canceled it, but at the same time, we're still going to have a good time, because I tell you what, my Sunday just freed up, and I know I'm going to be working. Don't worry that.
No, fuck. I think
I'm going to be there, you know, in the beginning, I'm going to make sure everyone's checked in and all that stuff. But by Sunday evening, I'm going to use that free pint card if I can get it.
Apparently, my Saturday and my Sunday freed up.
I know,
and I'm going to actually stay in Columbus for this.
You adapt, you change, you keep having a good time. That's the whole point of this. Is that so? If you guys, Altadis USA, thank you for the support and everything else. Typically, the second cigar, I appreciate everything that they do for us and the BS Cigar Company. So if you come around Sunday or any day in Columbus, Ohio, or if you guys are elsewhere, I had a guy actually reach out to me, and he's starting to get into cigars. And he's like, hey, I got a buddy that actually reached out to me and said, you have a BS Cigar Company? I'd love to review it on my new YouTube channel. How do I get it?
Nice.
And he's not in Ohio.
Nice.
And I'm like, we'll figure it out.
The
new
BS is awesome.
The new BS, I appreciate that. I'm very happy with it. So thank you to our sponsors. Guys, cheers. Tyler's smoking one right now.
Salud.
Cheers with the tin cups. Listen to that.
Salud, motherfuckers, with the tin cups.
Thank you guys very much. Stay tuned next week. We've got a great episode coming up with Spencer and also John Michael Moore. You'll hear more about that coming forward, going forward. And thank you guys. Happy Whiskey Wednesday.